A very good morning, everyone, and welcome to the second meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We've got no apologies this morning. And our first item of business today is an oral evidence session on the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Bill. So we've got three panels joining us this morning. And our first panel is Stuart Munro, convener of the Criminal Law Committee of the Law Society of Scotland, and Stuart is hopefully joining us online. Mr Fred McIntosh, KC, Faculty of Advocates, and Ms Joanne McMillan, committee member of the Glasgow Bar Association. So a very warm welcome to you all. And I refer members to papers 1 to 3, and I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. And as time is tight, I would as ever ask for succinct questions and responses. And on that note, I'll move straight to questions, if I may, and just ask our panel a very general opening question this morning. I'm going to refer to section 1 of the bill, which relates to input from Justice Social Work to inform bail decisions. So I wonder if I'm interested in your views on whether courts currently provided, if courts are currently provided with sufficient information when taking decisions on bail and remand. So I'll come to, it's a very general opening up question, I'll come to Fred McIntosh first, and then I'll bring in Joanne, and then we'll come to Stuart. So over to you.
Convener, I think probably Joanne is probably better placed to answer the question in detail because, of course, solicitors appearing for clients on remand are the people who are dealing with the cases. But I think there is a lack of material. I'm old enough to remember that in the early 2000s, almost every person who appeared from custody had a bail supervision report. It was almost standard. Not in almost every court, but quite a lot of the courts. And it meant that sheriffs were provided with information about addresses, about alternative addresses, about supervision, in a way that I don't get the impression they are now through our bail appeal practice. But luckily it's a good idea to provide more information. But I think ultimately I'd defer to Stuart and Joanne as people who are actually dealing with this on the front line.
Okay. Thank you, Joanne. I'll just bring you straight in.
Yes, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I noticed that a lot of you were at Glasgow Sheriff Court on Monday to have the pleasure of the custody court on a Monday afternoon. As you all saw, it's a very busy court. I've been a solicitor in Glasgow coming up now for, I think I'm now 11 years qualified, having practised in Glasgow in a legal aid firm throughout that time. I'm now a member of the Glasgow Bar Association, so we're all actively involved in terms of being in court on a daily, I'm there every day, usually have a custody most days, and I'm pretty familiar with the processes that are in place. I think it's fair to say that the bail supervision is something that's pretty new. Fred remembers back in the day when there were these provisions put in place. However, that seemed to not really take effect in the start of my career, and I don't really have much recollection of dealing with bail supervision when I first started off appearing. However, there definitely has been now a move towards far more use of the bail supervision, and the social workers, the bail officers who go to see the accused person when they're in custody and prepare a report, both in relation to electronic monitoring, and they assess them and check out addresses and suitability for being placed on electronic monitoring, but over and above that as well, to check out their suitability for supervision. And that really involves meeting with social workers on a regular basis. It's probably similar to being put on a community payback order pre-conviction. It's that same kind of work that's involved, dealing with them, checking in with them, making sure that they're staying out of trouble and making sure that they're complying. So overall, the GBA are very supportive of the bail supervision scheme. It's something which often when a client is on the cusp of being remanded in custody, that can be the thing that encourages the sheriff to grant bail, and perhaps gives the sheriff a bit of comfort in knowing that an accused person isn't simply just going back into the community with no support, and that they're going to be getting support from the social work department. And, you know, it's quite effective from the point of view of I had a case recently where I had a female who'd gone into the 218 project. I don't know if any of you are familiar with that. The 218 project in Glasgow, it's a third sector organisation that deals with women and women's issues. They deal with people that have got addiction, and as part of these bail supervision, there have been recent cases, and the one I've had, the accused was bailed to the 218 project. So in addition to the supervised bail project, in addition to the supervised bail report, the social workers were also involved, along myself and the 218, of having the client assessed for the 218 project, which meant that she went there on a residential basis and that she was given treatment and various different things within that forum, which is a really positive thing. So the bail supervision not only just deals with the social workers, but they bring together other agencies like the 218 project to try and provide a greater level of support for those that are very vulnerable and those that are very close to going to custody, and provide alternatives as well. So there definitely are pros to it. There are some difficulties in terms of the administration of it. Often, as you saw on Monday, it can be a very busy court. A lot of the time, the Crown do take a considerable amount of time to mark cases. So on Monday, for example, it seemed to go quite smoothly. That's not always the case. And you can find yourself sometimes, I had a case just before Christmas for a young 21-year-old vulnerable boy. He never had his papers marked until after 5 o'clock. He never appeared in court until, you know, 5:30. By that point, the social workers are away. The social workers don't assess them for supervised bail until they know from the Crown that their bail is going to be opposed. So we then ended up in a situation where a vulnerable 21-year-old remanded in custody overnight for the bail assessment to be done. So that there definitely are practical issues, I suppose, in terms of dealing with it. A couple of suggestions that colleagues have had, and I think the Sheriff Association have picked up, would potentially be for perhaps an earlier stage, even in the day, for the social workers to start their assessment, or even in a situation where the Crown might have the benefit of the bail supervision report prior to coming to a decision on bail, might help to inform their decision, and they might not then oppose bail. So if the Crown were to have that information and have the benefit of the bail supervision report, they might come back and, instead of saying, right, we're going to oppose bail, say, well, actually, we'd be content if bail was to be granted with supervision attached to it. And that would take away then the process of having to have the case. Well, the case would still require to call, but then there wouldn't have to be this time taken of going back and forth, arguing over whether or not bail should be granted. So there definitely is value, but sorry.
Yeah, this is really, really very helpful and interesting, and certainly, I think, fits with what we witnessed and what we observed on Monday in terms of the use of supervised bail. I suppose, and I'm just going to bring in Stuart Munro, if I may, just to keep things moving a wee bit. But what I'm also interested within that is the information that is provided to the court from Criminal Justice Social Work and potentially others, and we'll maybe come on to that later, that is informing bail decision making in relation to that, a decision around the potential for supervised bail. So can I maybe bring in Stuart Munro and just maybe ask for your views on the provision of information to the court in order to inform decision-making around bail. Stuart.
Yes, good morning. Thank you. I am appearing today in my capacity as convener of the Criminal Law Committee, and the Law Society obviously represents solicitors from around the country. But I am, like Joanna, a Glasgow solicitor. I spent the best part of 20 years going down to the custody court in Glasgow. Not done it so much in the last few years. But I absolutely echo what Joanna in particular has said about the crucial nature of social work input into bail decisions. The courts are very often dealing with incredibly vulnerable people, you know, vulnerable complainers, yes, vulnerable witnesses, yes, but also vulnerable accused, very many of whom have got complex social problems, whether it's addiction or mental health difficulties. And inevitably, only very limited information about any of that is likely to be available in the very short time that the court has to process these individuals through what can often be a very busy custody court. I don't know how busy the court was when the committee were there the other day, but back in the day, There were bank holiday custody courts in Glasgow that would exceed 200 people going through, and they all had to be processed in the course of an afternoon. So the social work input is absolutely critical. Fred's absolutely right. There used to be a very well-utilised scheme of bail information. Certainly, I remember back in the late 90s going into the bail information room where social workers were available to carry out urgent inquiries, make phone calls, search records, that kind of thing, in order to provide information to the court that would then impact upon bail decisions. We, though, as the Law Society, have had a look at this, the question of the extent to which such information is available around the country when there was the recent change to the availability of electronic monitoring as a condition of bail. And the committee will remember that that was reinstated not so long ago. And the experience, frankly, varied considerably around the country. Some courts were able to resource it, other courts simply weren't. And it all came down to, ultimately, local authority resourcing. The position was that in certain courts, following the reintroduction of electronic monitoring as a condition of bail, it was possible for an assessment to be carried out from day one. In other courts, it simply wasn't. And that, I think, highlights the problem. That ultimately we can all agree that the information is critical. The information will assist the court in making the right decisions in the interests of everybody, including public safety. But if the resources aren't there, if they don't have personnel in the courts able to deal in the way that Joanne says, very often late in the day after a late marking of a case or a late arrival of an accused person from a police station, then that information is simply not going to be available. And as I say, we're often dealing with incredibly difficult, vulnerable, often mentally, those with mental health difficulties, those with addiction difficulties. And without the information that comes from social work, it's very difficult to expect judges to make the right decisions.
Thanks very much. That's extremely helpful, and I think we'll open up some supplementary questions. I'm going to open it up now, and I think, Fulton, you want to come in, and then I'll bring in Jamie.
Convener, just to clarify, it wasn't necessarily a supplementary. I just put my hand up to say I wanted in. Okay. Is that all right? I'm just my question. Yeah, it is in this area, though, so it is following on. Convener, and can I just check with Stephen here, so I don't need to do it three times. I was going to declare interest to my refer to my members' interests. Can I do that once? There doesn't need to be each panel. So okay. So I do that. So thanks very much. It's on the discussion that we're having here just now about the bail supervision, and certainly when we were at the court the other day, Joanne, you're absolutely right. We've seen it in action. It was really good to see, and we've seen that the bail supervision assessments had been done a number of times, but of course not all of the times. But we don't know whether they were required. Does the panel think that the purpose of this bill is really to ensure that perhaps, going back to the old days, as to the two of the panellists referred to, that bail supervision assessments are done for every case? You know, whether that's a thorough assessment with somebody with complex needs, or simply, you know, a one-page assessment saying this person doesn't need bail supervision, that still an assessment should be done for everybody.
Yes. In terms of whether it's for everybody, I think there are some circumstances where it's probably not needed. So, for example, if you've got a client who is appearing and isn't asking for bail, so say they're remanded in custody for something else and they come down and appear, and in order to initiate the process, appreciate you were in the summary court, but in the petition court, what would normally happen is they would come down to answer the case, then they would either move for bail or not move for bail, and then that kickstarts the petition process. So there might be some circumstances where clients are not wanting to ask for bail, i.e. are already in custody. So it would be a waste of resources, I think, if it was to be in every single case. So perhaps if it's somewhere along the lines of saying where the accused is moving for bail and seeking bail, so is that the social worker not carrying out reports for people that are not asking for bail in the first place, or that those reports are unnecessary, and that might try and restrict the amount of reports that are required.
Yeah, I should have clarified that. I think that's what I mean. It's when bail has been sought, that they think that a report is always required, whether it's obvious or not. Yes. That maybe bail supervision isn't suitable, that the social worker still requires to meet the person and at least say that to the court.
Yes. Yeah. I think the case that I had on Monday when it called in court, I could tell that the Crown were opposing bail. the person had no previous convictions. I knew the sheriff was more than likely going to grant bail and that it wasn't necessary for bail supervision to be done. So I suppose I made a conscious decision as a professional not to have that assessment done, addressed it with the sheriff and indicated that, you know, if she was considering remanding the accused, which I didn't think was likely, then I would arrange for the supervision assessment to be done. So again, there's perhaps situations like that as well where you kind of know that it's very unlikely and that it's not necessary for supervised bail. But I suppose the majority of cases, I would say that it's necessary for young people, absolutely essential for young individuals to have supervised bail assessments done. And I think there definitely should be some sort of, if they're not going to do it in every case, then there should be a distinction, particularly for young people, that it be mandatory for young people.
Fred, would you like to come in?
Yes, I'm never sure whether I pressed the button or not. But
that's fine.
So it's worth saying that the world has moved on in two important ways since the 2000s, when this sort of existed before. The first is there's a much greater use of undertakings, where the police charge someone and then release them on an undertaking to attend on a later date, or even now on police bail. And that means that people will be out there in the community having been charged for weeks, in some cases, and recently it's been much longer than that. And then they turn up at court to receive the marking decision of the prosecutor. Now, most of the time, bail isn't opposed, but you always get that terrible story of, well, I turned up and suddenly, having been out in the community, hopefully behaving oneself, you turn up in court on your date and the fiscal opposes bail at that point. Now, to lawyers, that's not necessarily as mad as it sounds, but it happens. And so even people who are on undertakings may need bail supervision reports, perhaps only when the fiscal opposes bail. And the other thing is that fiscals no longer have the discretion that they used to have. So in the old days, and I'm looking at Stuart at this point, a fiscal, the marking would happen locally in the court, often by a more experienced deputy. And then the deputy in court would also have some discretion about what to do on the day about bail. And the impression I get, and I'm sure you can ask the Crown agent if they give evidence, is that fiscals now are much more bound by the marking decision. And that means that you can't really negotiate, in a sense, once a bail supervision report's in, because the marking decision's already been made. So it's probably not as clean as it used to be. And it will probably involve some form of local policy negotiated between the court and the fiscals and the social workers and defence agents, so that people know when to ask and how to ask. Because it isn't the old days where there were fewer cases and fiscals could change their minds, and they don't seem to have that autonomy anymore.
Can I just bring in Stuart? I think Stuart Munro would like to come in. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. Just to go back to Mr. McGregor's question, I think there's a danger in overthinking this. The bail supervision would ordinarily focus their resources on the cases that were going to be most problematic. There is very often in the modern day much better sharing of information between the various partners and the justice community. Certainly in Glasgow, as a member of the Glasgow Bar Association, I will get an email maybe at 10 o'clock in the morning in advance of the custody court starting in the afternoon, saying, here are the people that are going through the custody court this afternoon. Here's an update on what the fiscal has decided in respect of those cases that have been looked at so far. And there's regular updates on that. So a solicitor, before they even perhaps go to court, before they even go and see their client, might know what the Crown's attitude to bail is. Now, the Crown's attitude isn't necessarily the be-all and end-all of things, but that gives a step for a hint to the social work to know which cases are perhaps going to require the most resources. On the other side of the coin, there might be information. You may have a case where bail isn't opposed, where there is nonetheless helpful information that the social work department could provide that might assist, and might assist the defence and might assist the court in making decisions as to further procedure. But Fred's absolutely right. We have a more dynamic system. Many more people are released on undertakings. The question of bail arises in the undertaking setting as well. And I just think that the reality of the cut and thrust of both the custody court and the undertaking court is very often the position isn't clear until pretty late in the day. We do our best to try and anticipate what's going to happen, but there can always be changes at the end. And I think the key thing is that the resources that are available for bail supervision are focused on the cases that are most likely to be in dispute.
Thanks for that. And certainly, when we've seen it at Glasgow, it does seem that there's there's a good connection between the courts and the criminal justice social work team there. But I think what we've also heard is that it might not be the same everywhere. across the country. And actually, that's why I referred the committee to my register of interest, because I actually worked in this area previously. So my second question, Convener, if that's okay, was around how this could be implemented. So obviously the criminal justice social work teams that do the criminal justice social work reports for sentencing and the community payback orders when people are sentenced are separate generally, certainly in Glasgow and where I worked previously in Lanarkshire, are separate to the community justice teams. So bail supervision teams, you know, are a separate entity. They're usually, I don't know quite know the numbers in Glasgow, they're usually pretty small. Well, I'm not sure. I think it's maybe two folk. How do you see something like this working like that? If it do you? I mean, I know it's probably not for this panel to answer completely, but do you see it working that it would be specific bail supervision teams rather than the rest of the community justice team? Because people aren't sentenced yet. It's a very important distinction. In carrying out the work of bail supervision as well as the assessments, there's quite a lot of work. Where do you see that going in terms of resources if this is going to work?
In terms of Glasgow Sheriff Court in particular, we have a specific bail officers within the court. There's probably about four or five of them. Some work part-time, some work full-time. In addition to that, we also have the social work department, which is upstairs, which has a handful of social workers up there who deal with perhaps if you've got children that are in or need secure screenings or that sort of side of things. So there are quite a number of them there. So I think if you were rolling it out across the country, you would really need people within the court building to be able to go and see these custodies as opposed to simply just coming in later on in the day. I think you would then be in a situation where it probably wouldn't be happening. I think if they're in the building, the solicitors know they're there, the clerks know they're there, we're able to go in and speak to them and have a relationship with them, I think it makes the whole process overall work better. So, for example, in the case I had with the girls in the 218, the social worker is in regular contact with me. So if I bump into her, she'll give me an update as to how she's getting on. If there's any issues, she'll be able to contact me. So there definitely is very much a proactive working relationship between the defence, between the court and between the bail officers. And I think the only issue is they're pretty stretched in terms of their resources. And I think Stuart dealt with that at the outset in terms of the issue. So it's going to be something that will be an expensive exercise in order to roll it out, I think, across the country if it's not happening in the out-of-town courts. But it's definitely something that is worthwhile.
Yeah, and I suppose that's the point I'm making. And I'd ask the other two panellists if they generally agree with that. But, you know, if there's going to be more supervised bail, that means there's going to be more supervision of that. And sheriffs are expecting, we could see that even on Monday, sheriffs are expecting if supervised bail's in place that there's almost a package of support around that person. So that involves regular meetings with them. I can't quite remember exactly what the protocol was, but I think it's every second day or something like that the social worker needs to meet with the individual. It'll be different, it could vary, but in terms of that, that's a lot of work as well as preparing the bail supervision report. So, you know, I think that's the point I'm trying to make, is that if we're going to do it, it's going to take investment. I've just wondered if Fred and Stuart have anything to comment on what Joanne said?
Briefly, two things worth saying. Obviously, if there is more supervised bail, you might expect there to be less remand. There's obviously a saving there for SPS, but there's more cost to local authorities, and that has to be taken account of. The other thing is cases are taking longer to run than they did 20 years ago. And if you're on supervised bail for 18 months, which is not an unusual period for a non-domestic sexual priority case in some sheriff courts, that's seeing your supervisor officer weekly for 18 months. That's a lot of money. And so if you're going to save money in one place, it has to be replaced to speed things up and move things in others.
Stuart, do you want to come in?
Yeah, just a couple of things. In terms of the discussion is kind of moving slightly off from where it started. Supervised bail, I appreciate we've been referring to bail supervision officers, and that probably doesn't help any confusion. I think the team that Joanne was talking about in Glasgow Sheriff Court offer assistance to the court in making decisions about bail full stop. And so their input might lead to people being granted bail in standard conditions, but it might also lead to people being granted bail subject to conditions of supervision. Fred's right about the backlogs in the system, albeit the backlogs certainly in the summary side are not nearly as profound as they are on the solemn side. And somebody could be on supervised bail for a period, and if they comply well with it, maybe they don't need to be supervised anymore. And that kind of flexibility is built into the system. But fundamentally, in terms of the cost of resourcing, Fred alluded to, it's far cheaper, frankly, for somebody to be supervised on a bail order than to be held in remand. And there is, in the cases where it's the right way forward, far less social damage caused. You know, the interruption to that person's life, their family relationships, their employment, for example, of being held in remand can be ameliorated by them being held on supervised bail. So I completely appreciate that that comes out of different budgets, comes out of the SPS if they're on remand, the local authority if it's supervised bail, but there certainly is a social benefit in focusing resources in that direction.
Okay, thanks, Queen. Just to say, I wouldn't disagree with any of that.
Thanks very much. I'm going to move straight on to Jamie. We've got a number of members coming, wanting to come in. So, Jamie.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our guests. obviously, we've spent a bit of time talking about input from social work and other stakeholders in relation to informing bail decisions by sheriffs, and I don't think any of that is unwelcome. But there are other parts of the bill, perhaps, that deserve further scrutiny. In particular, I would like to focus on the parts of the bill that deal with grounds for refusing bail and the removal of bail restrictions. It sounds to me like, from the discussion we've had, that many of the issues that currently exist in the system are practical issues around the provision of information and the knock-on effect that would have on resources, either criminal justice, social work, or local authorities. But I want to ask about the legislation itself. It doesn't strike me as obvious that you need legislation to fix what are clearly practical issues in the system. You don't need statutory primary legislation to fix those issues. Those could be fixed as it is. So I'm asking is, why do we need a bill to reduce the man population? The government clearly thinks there are too many people on remand. That's the whole point of the bill. Is the remand population too high? And why? And does this bill appropriately deal with any perception that there is a high remand population? So it's quite a general question first, and I'll come on to a specific one after.
Thank you, Mr. Green. I think the first thing to remember is the remand population in Scotland is bigger, but it's not that dissimilar from the remand population in England and Wales. And there's recently been a report in the House of Commons, equivalent of this committee, about the English problems, which bears reading. I think the reason the remand population might be said to be too large is because everyone who is remanded is not necessarily receiving a custodial sentence. Now, to take a good example, which is raised by a number of groups in their responses to the original consultation, of domestic violence requires a rapid response from the justice system as a whole. And there was a day when trials happened quickly, and as Stuart has noted, the backlog is reducing. So if you need to remand someone because of the nature of the alleged offending and domestic violence, then you want to resolve the matter quickly. And then maybe remand is not so terrible. But if it's going to drag, or if the remand is less justified, then you're spending money and causing disruption for no good reason. And the reason I think you need a bill, primarily, is Section 23D. So my reason I'm here is I spent 10 years doing bail appeals. So the people who appeal their bail decisions, every morning, 10, 12 cases. And it is, I think, the case that there are people, I think that the judges and the sheriffs note this, who are remanded who probably wouldn't have been on the old system because they had a conviction for which they were sentenced to imprisonment on indictment when they were much younger, and they sort of changed, and they did something completely different to that allegation. Or their qualifying conviction was a bit odd, and therefore they got a custodial disposal when normally you get prison for that. And those people, it always seemed rather unjust, were having to meet an exceptionality test. And I'm not convinced there are people out there who really shouldn't have been, who were appropriately remanded by 23D, who it wasn't really justified, who was fully justified. There seems to be a small number of people who've suffered an injustice. And for all the times as a bail appeal lawyer you criticise sheriffs, they generally do a good job. And I think the discretion is important. And so getting 23D is essential.
get rid of that. And there seems to be quite a consensus. The other changes about the rest of the 23B and C particularly in the bill, it all depends on what ministers really intend and what you intend as a parliament. I think I wouldn't necessarily agree with everything that the sheriffs and the judges have said about the idea of the public safety test. But if it's intended to be a change, then it should be more overt. But if it's not intended to be a change of the test, it's all very pointless. Because the previous change in 2007 just rewrote the law. And I was very heavily involved in bails then, and the test didn't change, apart from 23D. But we had a new bunch of sections. And so it all slightly depends what the purpose is. If the purpose is to make it harder to oppose bail, which the Act reads as if it is, then all fine and good, and if that's what people want to do, then that will be the effect. But if the purpose is just to rewrite it in a new, elegant way, that might not necessarily be essential. And I've not really heard one way or the other what is actual the minister's plan. That may be me being a little cruel. But 23D is essential, that requires a bill, and that's a good thing,
yep.
And it's worth doing.
Okay, and your comments are on the record. And those are questions we can ask the government when they appear.
Absolutely, yes.
I'll come back to you, Joanne, in a second, because I want to move to the law side first, because in your written submission, your response to that question is, well, it's rather brief, and it's quite non-committal. I get the impression that the law society doesn't really have a view on changes to the grounds for refusing bail. You just state the obvious in the sense that judges give careful consideration to these matters. They judge each case on a case-by-case merit basis. Well, I mean, we all know that already, but you haven't actually made any commentary on those proposed changes. So I wonder if you could share a view, if you have one, now.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Green. I think the position of the Law Society is really aligned to that of faculty, which I think Fred has explained pretty well there. It is a few observations, I think. It's undeniably the case that Scotland, in common with England, sends people to remand more than many other jurisdictions do. Now, that is, I suppose, a political choice in the final analysis, and it's for parliamentarians to decide whether or not that's a good thing or a bad thing. I think from our perspective, the only observation we would make is it's important to consider all of the implications of a decision to remand somebody in custody. There are cases where clearly there is no alternative but to do that. But it is important to remember that not everybody who is accused of a crime is guilty of a crime. It's important to remember that not just the making of an accusation, but the remanding somebody in custody, the depriving them of their liberty when they have not been convicted of a crime, can have major implications, and not just for that individual. They can lose their job, they can lose their reputation, they can lose their later ability to travel or to participate in particular activities. But they can also lose family relationships. There can be huge implications for children, for partners, and so on. And all of these are important considerations. They always have been. But there are undoubtedly cases where people are remanded in custody where other alternatives could have been made available. As to the question of whether or not there is a need for legislation, absolutely. We agree that 23D is an unhelpful provision and its removal would be of benefit and would allow better decisions to be made by the courts without the exceptionality test that Fred refers to. The terms of the bill in respect of Clause 2, again, I can't really do anything more than echo what Fred says. It kind of depends what it means. The senators were very concerned about the original approach that was taken in the consultation paper, about whether or not there was a conscious decision to remove one of the legs upon which bail might be refused, and the implications that might have, for example, in persistent non-attenders to court hearings. That appears to have been dealt with in the bill that has now been presented. But really, the question is whether the phrasing of the clause will make a practical difference to the way in which individual sheriffs decide on bail applications. And at the moment, I don't think that's entirely clear. Now, obviously, it may be that if Fred or one of his colleagues takes a decision to appeal and there is clarity that comes from the appeal court as to what is specifically meant by the provision, there may be a change in practice. I'm not entirely convinced that there will be. And if there is a genuine desire on the part of Parliament to, as it were, reduce the numbers of people going on to remand in the Scottish criminal justice system, then it would help if that were a little more explicit.
Thank you very much for that. And Joanne, just as I come to you, I get the impression from what's been said that it's not necessarily the wrong people being held on remand for the wrong reasons. It's simply that there are too many people on remand because the trials are taking too long to come to fruition, which therefore will have an inherent knock-on effect of having more people physically on remand, and that dealing with the backlog, getting those trials to, getting those diets to pass more quickly would by default bring down those numbers quite quickly, and that's something maybe we should consider. But I just wondered if you had any views on what's already been said.
I would echo what Stuart and Fred have already said. I definitely do think there is great benefit to the provision of 23D no longer being in place. I think that does cause issues, and I think that the sheriff is not able to exercise their full discretion because they are restricted in relation to that. And in a situation where Parliament has explicitly said someone should not be getting bail in these circumstances unless it's exceptional, then makes it quite difficult for a sheriff to overrule that in the circumstances. So you could be finding yourself in a situation where someone is walking in on a bail undertaking where they've been on police bail for a period of time, they've got an old conviction on indictment, say for drugs, and they're appearing in relation to a new matter. They could have been out on bail for 6 months on police undertaking with no issues, they've turned up for court, and the Crown will be opposing bail on the basis that they're subject to the provisions of 23D. So there are definitely issues that arise with 23D, and I definitely agree with Fred and Stewart in terms of the issue regarding that. In terms of the overall amendments to the legislation, in terms of the public safety issue, I think my concern is, where is it defined? What is the definition of this going to be? Is it going to be a situation where ultimately sheriffs are just applying the same test that's already in place and considering the same factors that are in place? And if that's the case, then what would be the purpose? Or whether or not this is actually a conscious, you know, decision of the government and of Parliament to, you know, look at something and have something more revolutionary in order to try and deal with the number of people that are on remand. Or whether it's just, as Fred says, just another way of dressing it up in a different way, but it has the same outcome. So I think that would be the concern, and that we would find ourselves in a situation where, how do we define this? Where is it defined? Is it a case of, for example, a housebreaking? Is that considered a public safety issue because it's not a crime of violence, for example? But is that something that would fall into the provisions of that? So I suppose these are the kind of unanswered questions which I don't think the legislation really addresses. Mm-hmm. And ultimately it may well be it's going to be a matter for the court to address if the legislation is put into place, and then the court will have to make a decision by way of appeals. But it does create a bit of uncertainty in terms of looking at it overall, I think.
But I mean, you sit in the court day in, day out, you see dozens, hundreds, if not thousands of these cases. Do you ever get the impression that it seems to me that remand is used quite sparingly, and only in the most extreme of circumstances where the judge feels it appropriate. Just because the Crown opposes bail doesn't necessarily mean, remand is the outcome. So, do you feel that it's necessary for legislation to intervene and alter the outcomes of what is already happening? In answering that, and that's no disservice to the sheriffs or the decision making, but is it appropriate to narrow those parameters?
I mean, I think, again, I would just echo what Fred had said in relation to that point at the outset. It's going to depend upon what is the intention in this legislation, what is the aim of it. I think a major factor at this stage in terms of the reason for the number of people on remand are two issues. One is the Crown's approach to bail in cases, particularly summary cases, and that's something that the Sheriff Association picked up on in their response to the consultation as well. I think that was at 3.2 of their report. They had raised that as an issue as well. So we're in a situation where we're split into two levels of crime. We have petition level crime, which is the more serious, and the summary level crime, which is up to a maximum 12 months in the jail. We have legislation in place that says people shouldn't be getting sentences of under 12 months. We have legislation in place that says young people should not be going to prison, that there should be alternatives put into place. But time and time again, when I appear in court, you appear in relation to a case, you've got a 17, 18-year-old boy who's got a bit of a record, been in a bit of trouble, appearing on summary complaint, the Crown opposed bail. So you're in that situation, given the Crown's approach to the bail, that you're automatically then in this dispute as to whether or not there is going to be bail granted. So it may well be that something more has to happen in terms of the Crown's approach, so as that we're not in a situation where every single case is bail opposed. For example, a colleague of mine had a case recently where a young person, 18, week before Christmas, appears in the custody court for a summary matter. The sheriff admits him to bail despite Crown opposition. The Crown then appeal that. So you're then in a situation where not only the sheriff has decided he's to get bail, but the Crown then appeal it and he's then kept in custody. A young, vulnerable individual, the whole mechanism, all the legislation that's been put into place is to avoid these young, vulnerable kids going to jail. And he still ends up in jail, despite the fact that it's a positive decision by the sheriff. It's only then, when it then goes to Crown Office, when they consider the bail appeal, that eventually someone withdraws the appeal and he's released. But he's then been released from custody. He's not got anyone there to pick him up. And then you're in that vicious cycle. So I think it's... I don't necessarily know in terms of what you're saying about the legislation. I think that there are other things that could be done as well in terms of the Crown policy to be looked at in terms of these bail decisions. And it might reduce the number of people on remand if they're having a more pragmatic approach, particularly in relation to summary cases.
Yeah, thank you. Unfortunately, that's what we can only deal with what the bill does. We can't fix the other issues that
exactly.
could be fixed externally. Yeah. Thank you, Camille.
OK, thank you. I'm going to bring in Russell, followed by Pauline McNeill.
So, thank you very much.
If I can just, there's a lot to cover, so if I can ask for succinct questions and answers, that would be appreciated. Russell.
Thank you and good morning. I've got two questions. We've kind of largely or slightly touched on some elements of it already. The first one relates to part one of the bill and the grounds in which bail can be refused, being narrowed to two particular criteria, one being the significant risk of prejudice to the interests of justice, and the other being that of risk of public safety, risk to public safety. Now, we've heard from off the record from prosecutors there's some concerns about the lack of a legal definition of public safety, and a fear that if this is not properly defined in the bill, it will cause some problems in interpretation that will end up clogging up the appeal court. And I suppose what I'm asking is, should there be a definition? And what might that look like?
I think the problem is quite succinctly expressed by the judges in their previous response. And remember, these are the senators. And these are not the people who will interpret this legislation. So since the 2007 Act, we've had the Courts Act in 2015, which transferred the appeal court responsibilities for summary appeals, including all bail appeals by sheriffs, to the Sheriff Appeal Court. Now, they are a hard-working and diligent bunch of people, but they're not High Court judges. And the old system, the bail appeals were decided by a High Court judge, and therefore they would happily spend the rest of their day writing on things. And if you read the faculty response, you'll see a reference to a case called Smith against M, and I would actually encourage the clerks to make it available to you. It's from Lord Justice Clark Wheatley from the 70s. And on that day, he was instructed to do bail appeals. They happened in his chambers. There might have been five of them. I have no idea what he had planned for the rest of his day, but he spent the rest of the day writing that judgment. And it's the standard core decision on bail. It is virtually impossible, and I think this is because of time pressure, to get a similar written judgment out of the Sheriff Appeal Court, because they have other business. They're straight on to being the Sheriff Appeal Court. And it's that difference of status means that you won't get an interpretation very quickly in a written form that we can all use. I mean, the practitioners will rapidly work out, the word will get round, but it won't be in a published form of what public safety means. I think public safety should have quite a broad definition, personally. And I don't think Smith against M is particularly wrong, except possibly one element, which relates to the idea that it's sufficient that there's going to be a long sentence, so we'll lock you up now, which I always feel a little bit bad about, and I don't think that's quite right, given the presumption of innocence. But the problem is not so much the definition, it's what it sits into. It's this context of the whole system. And ultimately, is there going to be a systemic attempt to re-educate everybody, to change their approach, and to ensure that the system moves in a different way, perhaps a more Scandinavian way on summary justice? And if there is, will that include things that have been talked about on and off for years, such as use of bail hostels? Will it include reminder texts? Will it include legal aid being granted faster? Will it include there being more criminal defence solicitors who are under 50? And all the issues that put the system under stress, because it's more than just a definition. But I think the definition of Smith against M is a perfectly respectable definition. If you want to change it, the ministers really need to explain what they want to change. I mean, personally, I have views, but I don't think the faculty does, about how you would change it. And it's a conscious political decision for the ministers to say, we want less people locked up. And if that's going to mean the serial non-attenders aren't remanded, because it's, then what are we going to do about them not turning up? Because I think the judges explained that quite well.
So in Smith versus M, there is...
Yes, and it's a massively broad definition.
Right.
It's basically full discretion to the judges, please don't get involved, we're making the decision. And that's very contemporaneous of the time.
But yeah, presumably the bill seeks to narrow that, though.
Yeah, presumably, but it doesn't say that. And I feel that the ministers probably should explain.
Yeah. Okay.
Not least of which the Lord Advocate should explain as well, because that's part of the same operation in some senses. I hope that's helpful.
We can do without the courts having to interpret legislation from this place. We've got enough of that already, I think. Would either of you care to address that particular point? I think that has been very well explained, but I've got something else I can move on to if you prefer.
I would echo what Greta said.
Right, okay, thank you.
Stuart, do you just want to come in quickly?
I'm happy to agree with Fred in everything he said.
In perpetuity.
Yes. That's not an open-ended commitment.
The other element... which has been referred to already as Section 23D. Now, my understanding of that is it's Section 23D of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995, and there's a presumption against bail for certain types of offences, including violent sexual domestic abuse at summary level or drugs trafficking in solemn if there's a previous conviction to that effect. And that may be overly simplified, but that's more or less it. And all the speakers today are for the abolition of 23D, but we've heard last week from victims groups who are of the view that it should be retained. I just wonder if their views in any way cause you to rethink that, or if indeed it is to be abolished, whether it could or should be replaced by something else to give those protections to those victims.
Would you want to bring in?
I don't know. Whoever fancies it. I'm
happy to suggest one thought. I think the reasons the victims group are suggesting it are entirely valid. It's an anxiety that's very legitimate, and I wouldn't wish to in any way suggest that there's not a legitimate concern. But the way that I would suggest that you ensure that domestic violence, particularly offenders, are kept away from their complainers / victims, is, I think, by the way that the cases are prosecuted, the alacrity with which it's done, the level of commitment which is done. And that means it's a whole system response. So it's obviously bail supervision, if they're on bail. It's rapid disclosure by the Crown, early availability of dates, good liaison with the witnesses so they know when to come to court and don't fail to turn up, which often causes problems, even if the reason isn't particularly related to the case. And also the fact that, of course, it's worth remembering that a lot of the solicitors are currently not doing some of the cases where there are court-appointed lawyers. And I'm sure you can ask them about their reasonings, but it does mean that these matters are going slower because you need a solicitor in a domestic case because the accused can't quite properly cross-examine their own complainer. So you need a whole system's response. I do wonder whether the whole system's response might be more effective than 23D, which is more of a sticking plaster. And probably the people who are most dangerous and the one the victims group are worried about will be remanded anyway. And that's going to change.
Yeah. I mean, this is a much more overarching question. It's a final question, if that's okay.
Yeah.
It's about resources. The National Care Service is a work in progress, we're told. The Minister told us that it will be at least 2024 before we know whether criminal justice social worker is part of that. If bail is to be radically changed, whatever the outcome, it's almost certain it's going to put greater pressure on criminal justice social work. Now, I know you can't speak for that sector, but can you see how they could possibly cope with the likely increase in work, and that's probably one for Joanne and Stuart, I guess.
Yes, certainly. In terms of Glasgow, they definitely are very much stretched. They often are quite harassed, not the most helpful people you can deal with. They're very pleasant, very polite. They want to do, you know, their job to their utmost, but they are limited in terms of resources, and they're also supervising the bail as well as doing the assessments as well. So you could be in a situation where there's 60 custodies in a Monday and they're having to try and get through them. Often the cases aren't marked until after lunchtime, so often they're not able to see them in the morning, and then all of a sudden they get a flurry of requests when the bail position is finally known, and then there's a big queue to get into the cells, and all of those things add and make our life more difficult. But I definitely do think it has an impact upon the resources, and I think it would have to, there would have to be something done if there is going to be a momentous change, which there may be benefit to, but there would have to be an injection of money somewhere in order to address it.
Yeah, thank you. And feel free to come in, Stuart, if you would like.
Yeah, I wonder if we could maybe come back, Mr. Finlay, just on the previous point that you were making regarding 23D. As Fred says, of course victims groups have a legitimate reason to be concerned about this. Of course they will be anxious about what that might mean for bail decisions in the courts, but I think the concerns might be, to an extent, misplaced. 23D is an arbitrary provision. It basically says, broadly speaking, that the court can't grant bail where somebody is accused of a particular category of offence and they have a previous conviction for that offence on indictment. So what that means at a practical level is, if you have a 45-year-old man accused of a domestic violence offence, say, and they had a conviction on indictment for domestic violence 20 years ago, the court would not be allowed, in principle, to grant bail unless the exceptionality test were met. If, on the other hand, that 45-year-old man had half a dozen previous convictions within the last 3 years, but all on summary complaint, 23D wouldn't kick in. So it's a pretty arbitrary, one-size-fits-all kind of solution that doesn't really assist the court in making proper judgments as to who could or could not be trusted with being admitted to bail and let back out into the community. And as Fred says, again, the whole system response is the absolute key to this. There are examples, which I'm sure the committee are aware of, the Domestic Violence Court in Glasgow, the Evidence and Procedure Review pilot that's taking place in Dundee, Hamilton and Paisley, I think, where the idea is to basically try and transform the means by which summary justice is dealt with in domestic violence cases. You know, let's, instead of accepting a situation where somebody can go to the custody court today and have a trial in 6 months' time, let's try to accelerate that procedure dramatically by tackling all of the things that get in the way: court backlogs, delays in disclosure, delays in legal aid, and so on. Let's try to focus the whole process in much, much more quickly by making appropriate investment and changes, in order that if you have people being convicted of domestic violence offences, the courts can be much more proactive and engaged in trying to fix the root of the problem, rather than getting somebody 6 months later, by which time various things have moved on. And that, to my mind, is the way in which these things are solved. That is the way in which I think victims and complainers and witnesses can be given reassurance that the system is working effectively. But it's more than just making decisions around the issue of bail.
Thank you. Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill, followed by Rona Mackay. Pauline.
Thank you very much. Good morning. First of all, thank you for the evidence so far. I think it's really helped me a lot understand some key points, and it's been really focused. One of them that strikes me is that it's not joined up. There is an issue about resources. But just for the record, when the committee had questioned the remand figures last year, which is certainly a concern for this committee, which we've raised with ministers, the response that we got was that this bill would go some way to reducing the remand population. So I've always understood, although sure you're correct in saying you may not clear from the bill, but I always understood that's what we're attempting to do. So these issues of clarity, which have been raised by yourselves and others about what is a public safety test, and then we do need to get into the detail of, well, in fact, it was one of the issues that occurred when we were at the court on Monday, you know, was theft cases or housebreaking cases. Would they be public safety tests? So I think that's really, really helpful to hear. A couple of questions to you, Joanne. First of all, because you were saying that, you know, 12-month sentencing, the young people, and how we treat, and the approach of the Crown. And I think, Fred, you'd also said that the Crown don't seem to have any discretion any longer. I wondered if you thought that the centralised marking system had anything to do with it, because I've had concerns about it, because it's not, marking's no longer done locally. So, as you know, it can end up anywhere. And I think there's a real disconnect between fiscal through mark cases who don't know Glasgow, which I represent, for example. And I just wondered if maybe that you thought that might be one of the reasons.
I think in terms of the marking hub, the difficulty that we face, and I think Fred's touched upon this, is somebody is sitting in the house somewhere marking a case or sitting in this hub. I'm not quite sure actually where the hub ever is, but they always refer to it. But they're sitting in this place. They're making a decision on the basis of the paperwork that's in front of them. They don't have the benefit of the bail supervision report. They don't have the benefit of having spoken to the defence agent if there's an explanation behind it. They set out the bail position. They set out whether bail should be appealed if the sheriff grants bail. And then it's passed to a young fiscal in court who literally just stands up and reads off the reasons for it and has no discretion whatsoever to make a decision. So you're then in a situation where you might have the most exceptional set of circumstances, explain that to the fiscal. They might be thinking, totally get where you're coming from, but they're saying, my hands are tied. Someone more senior than me's marked this, or somebody else has marked this, and I can't overrule them. So it's taken away, like, at the local level, people being able to make decisions and been able to, you know, make decisions in order to expedite matters. So I do think that...
Because I think the committee noted that when the sheriff asked the fiscal in relation to one of the cases, whether or not the Crown... So that the witness had failed to appear on several occasions, and the sheriff asked the Crown if were they prepared for the trial in the first place, it was obviously determining the facts in the sheriff's mind. And I think the fiscal said, well, there's no notes here to tell me one way or the other. So they're just left with the notes in front of them. Yeah, so that's helpful.
So it's very limited.
Did Fred or Stuart want to?
Just say that there was a recent decision of the Sheriff of Appeal Court, which I won't name because I don't want to name the appellant. He doesn't really deserve it. But I'll send a copy to your clerk, which is a case I was involved in. But it's an interesting discussion from the Sheriff of Appeal Court of delays in a quite anxious case. And you might find it of interest, because I can agree with what Joanna said that there is a problem with Crown preparation, and they are overworked too. Let's not forget that.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll send that case to your clerk, and you might find it of interest as a sort of what can go very, very wrong example.
Thank you. Stuart, do you want to add
anything? I can just add that I rather suspect if the Crown agent or one of his senior colleagues were present, he would be saying, look, we are trying to enable our fiscals in court to exercise a degree of discretion. The difficulty is that very often just doesn't percolate down.
Thank you. Yeah, because maybe you don't know the answer to this, but my understanding is that fiscals have an individual commission when they're appointed, which is meant to give them the discretion as a fiscal on behalf of the Lord Advocate. Is that your understanding?
I'm not sure on that, but I do know that if you speak directly to a fiscal in relation to a case and you say, look, this is the circumstances surrounding this person's never been in trouble before, you know, this is their exceptional circumstances, this is a medical report confirming all the difficulties they've got, would you take a view, would you not proceed with it? And they're very much of the view, no, there's a policy, we can't make a decision in relation to that. So, for example, the other day I had a client who was remanded in custody for a serious solemn matter. He had a justice of the peace case and the Crown hadn't brought him down.
Mm-hmm.
We were on numerous trial diets and I said to the fiscal, look, would someone take a view in relation to this? He's already remanded in custody for something else. He's not been brought. We've had numerous trial diets here. The witnesses weren't present. No, I've been told I have to make another motion to adjourn it. So we're in this kind of churn and it's this, I'll go and speak to my boss. Then they come back and they say, no, I'm making a motion to adjourn it. Instead of somebody who's qualified, been able to make a decision in the court and say, do you know something? Is this really in the public interest for this to continue? It's been prosecuted at justice of the peace level, which is fairly low level in terms of the prosecutions. The person has got other issues and is not at liberty. Is it really in the interest for this to continue and to continue to create the churn and the backlog that there is there? And I think that churn and that backlog has a massive impact upon the overall running of the court, the length of time people are remanded in custody, the fact that the solemn stuff can't be dealt with because the courts and the fiscals are tied up with dealing with the less serious stuff that's been adjourned and adjourned and adjourned over and over and over again. So I definitely think all of that has a knock-on impact. And I think if the fiscals had a bit more discretion, that might make things a bit easier.
I just had one quick question about the case that you mentioned, Joanne, about the 21-year-old. I just wanted to understand, you said that social work finished at 5:30. Did that mean that that person was a disadvantage?
Yes.
Right, and is there any, to your knowledge, obviously need to ask social work what's going on there, but any idea why?
I think the only work
court's running till 7, and there seems that almost potentially a human rights issue there, because if you are taking it 2 in the afternoon and you get the benefit of social work, but you're taking it 5:30 and you don't, that is a clear omission of the system.
Yeah, and I definitely think it's down to resources. It's not down to the individuals. You know, they're doing their best in difficult circumstances and they work really hard, and I don't take that away from them in the slightest. It's the system. They need to, for example, they need to be there until the last custody is dealt with. So if that means that their shift doesn't start till 2 o'clock in the afternoon so that they're able to stay later, then that may need to be the case. But they shouldn't be expected to come in first thing in the morning and stay all day if they're not getting paid and they're not get the overtime and they're not getting the resources for that. I'm not suggesting that. But I definitely do think your client is at a disadvantage, and often it is the younger people, the young vulnerable kids, the ones that need to, these sort of additional supports, that are the cases that are later on in the day that do take a bit of time for the Crown to mark, particularly if they're petitions and they are more serious issues.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We're just into the last 15 minutes or so. I've got a couple of members still wanting to come in, so I'll bring in Rona and then Katie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I've got two questions to ask. The first one actually goes back to 23D and, you know, my colleague's earlier questions. I'm going to be very frank with you. I don't think your explanation of, you know, for the removal of 23D, which you unanimously agreed on, will reassure women's organisations or victims. I understand what you're saying about the whole system approach, but that's fine if it works. You know, that's fine if that works, and it's a big if. I can't quite grasp why. I mean, are you saying that that you want to have the ability to release a domestic abuser? You know, why would that ever be correct? That's what I can't really understand. And so I'm possibly just not understanding your reasons for wanting to, why not keep the exceptions to reassure victims and organisations? I'm not sure of your reasons for that. That's my first question.
Can I ask that? I mean, I think the first thing to remember is that 23D applies to all categories of cases. And so that means, as a matter of definition, from the point of view of the sheriff, they are not releasing a domestic abuser. They're releasing someone accused of being a domestic abuser. Now, I appreciate that on a law of averages, they may well be guilty. With that remembered, because I think it has to be important, we have to remember 23D applies in a wide other group of circumstances. The next thing to remember is that these are often being prosecuted at summary level. And so if they're being prosecuted at summary level, unless there's a bail aggravation, in which case they're going to get remanded anyway because there's a bail aggravation and they've got previous conviction of domestic abuse, so they're going to get remanded anyway, then they're looking at a maximum 12-month sentence. And we're, of course, trying to discourage those. And there are very well-resourced and intelligent programmes for people convicted of domestic abuse that are community-based. So if we're going to be remanding people, we're not remanding them as a sort of prepayment on punishment. We're remanding them purely to protect the public. And the question of whether the public needs to, largely the person who's accused them, needs to be protected, is the sort of decision that sheriffs are very good at making already. And so in the case of a summary case where, an example that Stuart gave, a 45-year-old with three or four previous convictions for domestic abuse in recent years, I'd say they're almost certain to be remanded. But the person who at 45 has a previous conviction for violence committed when they were 19 on indictment, perhaps a sort of thuggish behaviour, and now they're in their 40s, nothing's happened in between, 23D applies to them. And I would suggest if someone's accused on summary complaint of domestic abuse at the age of 45 with one previous conviction for when they were 19, nothing in between, perhaps a good work record, they wouldn't necessarily not get remanded were it not for 23D. And so if 23D is arbitrary, that's something we should rather avoid in the law. And there was a time when we had a whole systems approach to domestic
abuse prosecutions, when it sort of started in a big way in the sort of early 2005-6-7 period, the ministers, the Lord Advocate was, and the police were very keen on pushing these through quickly. And the quicker it goes, I would suggest, the less chances are that the wheels will come off bail. And so my suggestion is that, yes, it will create an anxiety, but we should try and reassure people rather than have an arbitrary rule in our system. Because we got rid of the arbitrary rule, for example, that murder was never available, because arbitrary rules are a bad idea. And so that's my answer. I'm not sure it's going to satisfy you there.
Well, I mean, I'm just taking it back to very simplistic. I mean, I understand what you're saying, but taking it back to perception and a very simplistic level, that's not how victims of domestic abuse will see it, or women's organisations, because it still does give the perception that it's going to be easier for alleged perpetrators to be out on bail.
I think it's worth the members of the committee remembering what happened, why 23D came in the first place. There's a lot of the press reports are still online. There was a distressing incident in Livingston, which you can find out about, where someone had been released on bail and they then committed a serious crime. And I can't actually remember which crime it was, but it was very serious and had a sexual nature. And the then First Minister, I think it was Jack McConnell, stepped up and insisted that this law be changed. And the whole of the current bail regime, the 23s, were changed on the back of that. Now, it could be the case, and it's a matter for the committee, not for the faculty, that these hard cases do make bad law, and that that was perhaps, in retrospect, a knee-jerk reaction by the legislature and the government. But ultimately, you've got to make a balancing act as a committee and as a parliament. And I think we're saying is that probably in most cases, the decision, almost all cases, the decisions that you're worried about would have been made anyway without 23D.
So the individual risk would be taken into consideration just as much as public.
Sheriffs are very reactive on domestic, because there's the old statistic. I can never remember how many times people are supposed to have carried out an act of domestic abuse before someone reports it, but that is a academically well-respected, if not relevant in individual cases. So judges are very, sheriffs are very alive to the fact that this probably didn't come out of the blue, shall we say. Yeah. And so if people have previous allegations, or they previously breached bail or failed to comply with court orders, or driven out insurance and done things that show they don't really care, sheriffs are pretty firm. And so I would hope that it will be managed by applying the rest of the system. Now, of course, if you change the rest of the system, that's a different point. But 23D is probably unnecessary overreaction.
I'm conscious of time. I've got one other question. So rather than ask everybody to respond, I'll ask my other question. It's really for Joanne. So it's currently estimated that at any one time, 30% of the female population is on remand. That's it. In Scotland, that's to me, that's a huge number. 54% of them lose their tenancies, 61% have children, and huge knock-on effects for families in that. So you talked about a case where the woman went to the 218 project, which is very successful. Why does that not happen more often in your opinion? And is it, a lack of resources or
going to... Yeah, I think it's probably a combination of lack of resources. Also, it can sometimes be quite difficult to get clients motivated in order to go into these places. But there are great benefits to it. I mean, fantastic benefits.
But are all sheriffs aware of these options?
Yeah. Certainly in Glasgow. I'm not sure about outside of Glasgow, because the 218 is a Glasgow programme. Uh-huh. But I mean, it did take a bit of work to get it done. I was phoning the 218, speaking to social workers. It was continued overnight. There were all sorts of things that were done so that there was support put into place, lengthy reports prepared, all of that sort of stuff.
Does it go down to individual solicitors like yourself who actually know about these things and will proactively look for them, or some that just say, well, this is a system, this is what happens?
I'd say
you'll be demanded.
I'd say the majority of solicitors probably do it, because just of the nature of the job we do, we do want to help people. We don't get paid to do any of these extra things. I could quite easily just have gone in and said, these are our position, for bail. But I didn't. I went to speak to the 218, went to speak to social workers, spoke to the client, did all of that. Okay. And it's because I think inherently as a profession, we do want the best for our clients. We want to see them rehabilitated. We want to see them improve their circumstances.
But there would be less women in remand if these people were able to go to these.
Absolutely. If that was rolled out across the country in every court and every, maybe not every court, but every sheriffdom, then there would be these organisations in place that, in essence, people are bailed to. And it's given a more caring and nurturing environment as opposed to locking them up in Cornton Vale and putting them in with hold
of the high incidence of mental health and addiction problems and domestic abuse victims. That's fine, thank you.
I'll bring in Katie and then Colette.
Thank you.
Just to watch the time as well.
I've got two questions, if that's okay, convener. The first is on the public safety test that's in the legislation. And as we know, it's simply not defined, which could cause a great deal of problem. Have you given any thought to how that test could be defined if we were to keep it in the bill? How could we define it? And it may be that I'm putting on you the spot too much now, so we'd be quite happy to hear from you afterwards in writing. Shall I take Fred first, maybe, on that one?
I don't think the faculty has a view on how it should be defined. I think the comment that's probably most powerful is that of the Lord Justice General in his response. And ultimately, if the current test is Smith against M, and as set out there, and it hasn't changed, despite the change in 2007, it's probably incumbent on the Scottish ministers to explain what they're trying to change. Mm-hmm. I can see an advantage, if you want to reduce numbers, in removing the consideration of how long the sentence will be as a factor. Beyond that, it's quite difficult because it's quite a holistic process. But certain policies will reduce numbers. So Section 23D, to take the previous comment, will reduce numbers of both female and male prisoners on remand because it applies to both of them. But beyond not taking account of the length of the likely sentence, nothing immediately springs to mind. And I'd be interested to know what the ministers say if you ask them.
Thank you for that. I don't know, Joanne, if you've got any thoughts on that.
I would just simply agree with Fred in relation to that.
And I don't know if the Law Society would like to come in on this, whether that's something, might be something to consider after today, or whether you've got any initial thoughts.
No. Likewise, I mean, I think the Lord Justice General put it well in the senatorial response. If the concept of public safety is to mean the protection of the public from any offending behaviour, the outcome regarding remand in custody may be a little different from at present. If, on the other hand, it's to be understood as to referring to safety in the ordinary sense, like freedom from injury, danger or risk, then many offenders who appear in the summary courts charged with things like theft and who pose a substantial risk of continuing to offend while awaiting trial will require to be released on bail. So really, I think it's for ministers or for Parliament to determine what they want the provision to mean. It's then for the lawyers to try and implement that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem is we might end up in the same place, but it might be a lot of appeals before we end up in that place.
A lot of time and money is spent getting to exactly where we are already.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Stuart. And my second question is about virtual custodies, which is an issue that we've been discussing over an extended period of time and is something where the Scottish Government may come forward with firm proposals on a later date. And particularly given what Joanna said and has expressed so clearly in terms of the importance of discussions, of speaking to all the parties, the police, the social workers, the procurator fiscal, the value in face-to-face discussion and talking. In what circumstances do you think virtual custodies would work? And I'll start with Joanne because she has been talking about some of this.
I think they should really be the exception, virtual custodies. The virtual custodies, I was never a fan of. I don't think many practitioners were a great fan of them. But the difficulty is it takes the human aspect out of your job. You know, we're dealing with, as Stuart said at the beginning, vulnerable individuals who've got mental health difficulties. Often we are the only professional person in their lives that they trust. And to have a 2-minute phone call when you can't see them, often upset, you can't, you know, reassure them. The social workers then can't go and see them. They get a kind of vibe from their presentation and see how they are. If all of that's done over the phone, it totally takes away the human aspect to it. And I think it would be detrimental. Now, there are benefits for virtual custodies. There are situations where people are brought up to answer warrants from all places down south. You can wait until 8 o'clock at night for them to appear when they eventually appear. and bail's okay, so it could be something that quite easily could have been logged on to the police station down south for them to be able to appear remotely and for that to be dealt with. So there are exceptions, and I do think there is the benefit for certainly cross-border things where it's not contentious or it's fairly straightforward and we're not having to expend the resources in terms of having the cost involved of the police holding them and bringing them up and all the things that are involved in that. But for the run-of-the-mill custodies, the majority of folk who are vulnerable, I'm not a fan of the virtual custodies.
When somebody's already in custody for something else, so that there's no possibility that they would be getting released anyway, that would be for an example of an exception, perhaps.
They wouldn't be in the police station, I don't think, though, if they were already in custody for something else. They're usually brought directly down from the prison to the court in order to deal with that. There may be set circumstances where it's not a custody appearance, it's just a regular appearance in court. They might be, like, full commits are done by video link. So that's when they first appear, they then appear for full committal a week later, and that's done by video link. So there are some benefits to those side of things. But overall, I think for first appearance, it's very important they're present.
And I appreciate that we're running out of time, but I don't know if Stuart has anything that you'd feel able to add to that.
I just wanted to say, Ms Clark, if I may, that I think virtual custodies are a complex issue that really require a bit of time for representations and consideration to be given. There are a whole range of aspects that come into this. One is the reality of the experience for people who are accused of being taken from a police station where they're in a cell on their own and put into very often very poor accommodation in the back of a court where they're maybe sharing with seven or eight other people and held there for hours and hours with very limited access to anybody. I think the question of whether you can do that virtually really comes down to what virtual custodies in practice mean. I completely agree with Joanne. The idea that you can do that over a phone call is nonsensical. There are technologies available, very high quality video conferencing, that can minimise the limitations that come from having a consultation with somebody with a screen in the way. But I think for virtual custodies to work, and they may have a place, it would require the right technology, the right resources, very careful planning and implementation, an ability to ensure that we can still engage with folk like the bail supervision people and the Crown and so on. But fundamentally, you have to make sure that the accused person is able to effectively participate and able to effectively communicate with those they need to communicate with, including their solicitor. That's a very difficult thing to achieve. I don't think it's impossible, and the Law Society doesn't think it's necessarily impossible, but it's just very, very difficult. And the virtual custody tests that we have had so far haven't come close.
I don't know if the Faculty of Advocates...
Yeah. Stuart just said it makes perfect sense. You're here in a room. There's a reason you're here. It's the same, I suspect. But you can do it remotely. It just requires lots of thought.
Okay. Thank you. And I'm finally going to bring in Colette
Stevenson. I've just got one question. It's relating to the reasons for refusing bail. So the bill is looking to actually expand the current requirements for a court to state the reasons why they're refusing bail. And I'm just wondering, and record that as well. Do you think that that's going to be helpful? I'll bring in Stuart first.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. Yes, I think it absolutely is. And ultimately, if a court is taking away somebody's liberty with all of the implications that has, it doesn't seem too much to expect that there will be some careful reasoning recorded for that. I don't think there's any practical difficulty why that can't be captured in writing as well as given orally. So, yes, I think it would be helpful.
I don't know if Fred or Joanne.
I slightly differ to Stuart, right? And Fred, actually, in terms of if you're appearing in court and the sheriff refuses bail, the sheriff will address the client directly and say, these are the reasons why I'm remanding you in custody. In terms of them providing a written explanation, I personally am of the view that it's not necessary unless you're putting an appeal. So if I was then to mark a bail appeal, they would then provide a report. And I think at that point it would be helpful for written reasons. But I think the sheriffs, I think, are under a bit of pressure. There's, you know, pressure of workloads. And I think it'd probably be an unnecessary step for the sheriff to write written reasons for every decision when the decision potentially is not going to be challenged further.
OK, that's interesting. Thank you. OK, thanks very much indeed. Just to note, just for the record, we have the Crown coming in next week to give evidence. So obviously some of our discussion today has referenced that organisation. So it'll be interesting to hear some of their commentary. Before we do, I'm just going to bring the session to a close. But before we do so, we haven't really had a chance to cover part two of the bill. And obviously, we've now got our second panel of witnesses who have joined us in the committee room this morning and may be interested. I would like to ask you, before we finish, just about any specific views that you have on part two of the bill around release from prison, particularly perhaps around the issues of Friday releases, power to release early, and also the key issue of release planning. So I'll do it in reverse order. I'll bring in Stuart, and then I'll come to Joanne and finish with Fred. Stuart.
Well, thank you, Convener. The Law Society agrees with very much of what is set out in the bill. Really, it's the same position at the other end as with the bail supervision. You know, decisions about remanding custody have to be made on as informed a basis as they possibly can be, and equally, letting somebody out of the prison environment should be done in a way that is made with as much planning and care as possibly can be achieved. I think the families outside submission was particularly interesting in that respect. Ultimately, there is nothing worse than a vulnerable person who has been disconnected from society for a period of time, being turfed out of a prison, goes back, doesn't have anywhere to stay, doesn't have any way of accessing services. All that that is likely to achieve is that that person's rehabilitation is put at risk, and there's a risk of further offending and the cycle begins again. I think it really is important, and there's a huge social benefit in planning taking place, and the objectives of the bill in that respect are to be commended.
Thank you, Stuart. Joanne?
Yeah, in terms of the release not on a Friday, I think that's a great idea. I think for people that get out of prison, they've got no accommodation, they need to get prescriptions, often they're on methadone or other substitutes, and if they're getting out late in the day and there is nothing available to them, nobody's working over the weekend, then it's just, it's only a matter of time before the phone goes and they're back in custody. Mm-hmm. So I definitely think there is value for the Thursday or early release in terms of not on a Friday. In terms of the issue with regards reintegration licence in particular, my colleague Lorna, she specialises in parole matters and deals with a lot of parole cases. I was discussing it with her, and ultimately there is already in place the HDC, which allows an individual to be released on reintegration licence 180 days prior to their parole qualifying date. However, the difficulty in practice seems to be that the starting of the parole process in terms of them getting their dossier from the prison and a hearing being fixed, that's not happening until at least sort of 8 to 10 weeks prior to the parole qualifying date, by which point it then needs to go to the parole board. They then need to make a decision on it. So the parole board are making a decision right up until the last minute, and it can be, you know, a matter of a couple of weeks or so before the parole qualifying date that the parole board are making the decision, mm-hmm. or even after the parole qualifying date that they're making the decision. So if this was to be put in practice, and if this was to be, you know, encouraged that there would be this reintegration licence prior to release on parole, then I think things would have to change overall in terms of how it operates to ensure that we're in a situation where they are given the opportunity and that the parole decisions are not being made right at the last minute, so is that there is a benefit and there is an opportunity to utilise it. Mm-hmm. And again, it comes down to resources, it comes down to the coursework in the prison. There are considerable backlogs already in relation to them doing the coursework in the prisons. And that's a major issue as well. So really that needs to be addressed as well. If all these things are then going to come in together and work into play in the model way that it should. So I think there are other bigger issues that require to be addressed if all of these things are going to work.
Thanks, Joanne. Fred, finally.
I would agree with what Joanne and Stuart have said. I would end with a little plea. The Prisoners and Criminal Proceedings Scotland Act 1993 is an extremely badly drafted piece of legislation. It is said by those who practice in the field that if you think you understand the 1993 Act, you don't understand the 1993 Act. There's a wee plea in paragraph 15 of the faculty response. Can you please rename the sections so they actually describe what they do? Because they're not clear. And if I, as someone who litigates in the inner house or challenging the parole board, find it hard to remember what sections do, because they didn't even describe what they do within them. How on earth is a family member trying to understand the law that's going to apply to their family member, or a victim trying to understand the law, going to understand it? And if there's anything you can do just to make this part of this act a little bit more user-friendly, you'll be doing a great task.
On that note of a plea from our colleagues, I thank you all. That's been a very interesting session. Thank you for your attendance. On that note, we'll just have a very short suspension just to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you. Welcome back, members. Our second panel today consists of former Sheriff David Mackey of Howard League Scotland, Professor Nancy Lowkes, Chief Executive Officer at Families Outside, and Ms Wendy Sinclair-Gibbon, HM Chief Inspector of Prisons. So I welcome you all, and as with our first panel, I'm just going to move straight to questions, and I intend to allow around about 60 minutes for this panel. So I wonder if I can start off just with a general opening question, and I'm going to come straight to part two in relation to release from prison, release from custody. So I'll maybe come to yourself, Wendy, first of all, and then Professor Lowkes, and then David. So with the aim of supporting the successful reintegration of prisoners back into the community, the bill includes provisions on release planning and standards of through care support. Do you feel the proposals are helpful, and would you like to see any changes within the provisions? So, Wendy, over to you.
I think the proposals are helpful. I've long been of the opinion that discharge planning, if you like, should be following a healthcare model, in the sense that the minute you go into hospital is when you start the discharge planning. You may be in hospital for a long time, but managing the discharge starts day one. And therefore, having the bill as backup to look at discharge planning has considerable benefits, I think, to actually change behaviours about how we manage discharge planning in Scotland. I have some doubts about whether the efficacy of even earlier release would be effective. So, you know, I think that needs to be operationalised before I could comment further on that. So that aspect of the bill, but just the fact that the bill actually looks at it for the first time, really, really appreciated and welcomed.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Wendy. Nancy.
Thanks very much. I agree that the bill is very, very helpful in this regard, and it does spell out some of the considerations that need to be taken in preparation for release. I agree completely with Wendy about the need to plan for release from day one. One of the previous witnesses spoke about access to courses that are required for release, and one of the questions that we have at Families Outside is about the necessity sometimes for people to move from their local prison to prisons that are further away, which can damage family contact at a time when they need it most. Whether there's an option to look at other opportunities such as peripatetic services where the courses actually travel around to the different prisons rather than requiring people to move, and the cost that's involved to families in trying to maintain contact when someone is in a prison much further away. I do think that there are some additions to the bill that could be made broadly, both this part and in the previous section as well. I think there could be more recognition of the impact on families at the point of remand and at release. So there needs to be more inclusion of support, involvement and consideration of families in the bill. I also think there could be more reference to the role of the third sector in providing these types of services, because they do provide a huge amount of input throughout remand and sentence, and certainly on release, and that isn't really included or specified. I think that would be very useful.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Nancy. And David, I'll bring you in now.
Yes, I agree with everything that's been said, agree strongly that any through care provisions should be strengthened and in a sense replaced. They were there before, and the notion that the Scottish Prison Service would have responsibilities following then transferring into local authorities, I think is a very constructive approach. We shouldn't lose sight of the importance of third sector organisations in this area, especially organisations that can offer close mentoring support, because it's that sort of close support in the first hours, nights, days that matters most. And in the current economic climate, I know that the funding of these organisations, some of whom are very small, is an issue, and some of them are facing existential problems because of funding. I don't have the answer. I'm really just raising the importance of third sector organisations in this work, in helping people reintegrate back into the community.
Mm-hmm. Thanks very much. We recently have visited a third sector organisation that supports individuals at the point of leaving prison. What came across for me very strongly was timing and the value that they seemed to express in the likes of third sector organisations being able to almost insert themselves into prison prior to an individual walking out of the gates. And I find that very powerful in terms of catching somebody, as it were, before they walk out of the prison and potentially are lost to services or difficult to engage with. I'd be interested in your views on that, because for me that made complete sense, and I would like to explore your views on that a little bit more. So I'll maybe come to Nancy first.
I think the reason that that is absolutely critical is because building those relationships and establishing some sort of trust prior to release is essential for people to engage after release. One thing that I would like to see is recognition that some people who are going into prison may already be working with third sector organisations, mm-hmm. may already have key workers, for example, but that gets lost as soon as they enter prison. The third sector organisations may suddenly just not have someone turning up for appointments, for example, and not know why, because they're not told that the person is in prison. So it's making sure that you can ideally maintain that relationship or continue that relationship where it already exists, mm-hmm. and making use of that type of provision as well. I think we can certainly act more creatively on that. The through care support officers that the prison service had in existence until just a couple of years ago was actually very highly valued, because again they were in prison and establishing those relationships from the beginning, and it was also very enlightening and rewarding for the staff, the prison staff, to see that and to see a different side of the challenges that people face when they're released from prison. I think that was a real loss when that service was suspended. So there are a number of ways of going about this, but that having that support prior to release and then continuing into the community is absolutely mm-hmm. essential.
Thank you. Wendy?
I can't say how strongly enough I support that. The reality is that I think it needs a combined effort. The through care support officers for the building relationships with the prison staff is excellent, cannot replace and must be seen as an adjunct to community support. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, what's important is that that person leaves prison and another victim isn't formed. That's the most important part. The victims need to know that while they're in prison, the issues that caused them to commit the crime in the first place or to tangle with the police in the first place are being addressed. And therefore, if support is what is needed to find housing, reduce their legal commitments, sort out their debt, sort out their health problems, addiction problems, that prevents the next victim, that is something we should be doing. And I think it's something that victims should accept.
Thank you, Wendy. And David?
Yes, I agree with everything that's been said, but I would add that I think that thinking about the exit from prison and the through care arrangements at the point of exit is too late. Mm-hmm. And I think that the planning, the thinking about leaving prison should start pretty much as soon as the sentence is imposed. Mm-hmm. In court, I have said to people I've sentenced, before they've left the dock, they might be feeling pretty shell-shocked at the moment and pretty down, but I would like them to turn their mind to their leaving prison in however many months it might be. The concept of mentoring, peer mentoring especially, by life-experienced mentors, mm-hmm. Is one that I would support very strongly, and that's the sort of third sector organisation I had in mind with my previous answer. And that, if you take the concept of mentoring to its logical conclusion, then the mentor should meet the person as they leave the dock and accompany them through their journey throughout prison, planning not only planning their time in prison, making best use of it, but also preparing them for their exit. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I think I have nothing to add to what's already been said by the other witnesses. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I'm sure there'll be some more questions on this particular topic to follow. So I'm going to bring in Colette and then Russell. Colette.
Yeah. Thanks, Convener. And good morning. It's still morning, sorry. I wanted to touch upon release on licence for long-term prisoners as well. And one of the stats that actually came up in touching upon progression, and as you know, Wendy has been an independent prison monitor, what some of the biggest cases that you get or the biggest issues is progression through a long-term sentence. And one of the stark stats that came out was that the open prison is only being used, it's only being utilised at 52% or something at the moment, which I thought was... But the bill in itself is looking at, in terms of when they're on release, removing that home detention curfew with a view to, you know, reintegration licence, with a new system of a temporary release as well. But again, the open prison, does that not, in terms of a temporary release, does that not bode well there as well? So if I can bring in Wendy and then Nancy and then David.
I think there's two things for me. One is we're ignoring 25% of the prison population, which is remand. And that is a significant concern for me, because while they're on remand, we aren't tackling any of the criminogenic factors, or very few of the criminogenic factors that actually led them to commit the crime or potentially link the crime in the first place. So, and that doesn't affect progression. The two top complaints to us, or requests for an IPM, are around progression, which is the prisoner journey. So from when they're convicted, what happens to them? And there are various hoops that they have to jump through and various assessments that go on before they can reach the open estate or release, depending on the length of sentence. The progression system hasn't worked, isn't working, and still isn't working post-COVID, and requires significant effort to make it work. So you have people waiting significant periods of time to be able to progress to the next stage, even though they've been cleared for the next stage. Now, to give the SPS its due, there's been a 25% increase in the number of people going to the open estate, so work is progressing. But the open estate is still very much underutilised, and it's a fantastic resource for testing people in the community before they're finally released. So for me, I agree with you. Getting the prisoner journey right, getting them through the system so that they can be tested, so that they can be properly assessed to make sure their risk is reduced on release, is vital. And currently, that's not working efficiently.
Nancy.
I don't get the impression you're going to get a lot of disagreement on this panel, but just to say I would echo what Wendy has said, but also reiterate the role of families in all of this. We know that people who maintain positive relationships with their families, the risk of reoffending is reduced up to 6 times. A lot of that is for very logical reasons. People are more likely to have a place to live when they get out. They're more likely to have social support, financial support, links to employment, and so on. But it's recognising the role of families throughout this progress through remand and sentence and release, because it's the family's journey as well. And certainly that's something that families tend to be absent from quite a lot, and particularly if you're looking at something like parole and licence conditions. They're not included in that conversation yet. If someone is restricted to where they can live or where they can work, that's going to have an impact on the family as well. So I'm very, very keen for that to be recognised and included and supported, so that families are able to take part along the way. And some of that might be families where they've been the victims of the offence and are very worried about what happens on release. So it's recognising that as well, and being able to factor that into the planning.
OK, thank you. David, do you want to come in?
Yes, very briefly, because I there's nothing I can usefully add to what my fellow witnesses have said, and they have greater expertise in this area than I do. The one point I would emphasise, really picking up on what the Chief Inspector said, that in relation to progression, there is a huge emphasis on prisoners achieving results in the existing scheme. And I would encourage the notion that there might be other ways of being found of measuring their preparedness for return to the community than to focus on the courses that currently are requiring to be completed before progression takes place.
Can I just comment back in on the courses themselves in terms of rehabilitation, so that it reduces reoffending as well when they do come back out into the community? Do you think the current courses that are available, I mean, we know that it's hard for them to progress through to get onto those courses, but the courses in themselves, do you think that they actually work in terms of, you know, reassuring, you know, victims and the community? And also, should there be an overlap when they do go through into reintegration, that those courses continue as well?
It's interesting. There's a considerable body of research into this, and that there is shown that the risk is reduced, the likelihood of reoffending is reduced by doing the accredited offending behaviour courses. There are also a whole pile of courses under What Else Works, things like the Sycamore Tree Restorative Justice run by the Chaplaincy. Now, they haven't been researched and accredited in the same way, but the accredited offending behaviour courses definitely have a positive impact and therefore need to be considered. Like David, I firmly believe that there are other things as well that need to be considered. You know, whether you've sorted out the family relationship, whether you've sorted out accommodation, whether you've sorted out the addiction issues, whether you've sorted out the outstanding warrants, whether you've sorted out, you know, the behaviours that have gone on before, those need to be looked at in addition to the offending behaviour programmes. Reliance on offending behaviour programmes when there is a waiting list for them simply builds frustration.
Thanks, Wendy. David, do you want to comment on that?
No, I've nothing I can usefully add to that.
Nancy?
I think it is worth reiterating what Wendy said, and that the offending behaviour courses are very useful, but they focus on the behaviour of the individual. They don't focus on the context that they go back out to. So when we have a situation where there are long-standing issues such as mental ill health, substance misuse, lack of housing, lack of employment, all of those things, there are kind of structural features, and the fact that the stigma of a prison sentence, having a prison record, isn't going to help people resettle on release. So it's recognising these are broader factors that we have to recognise and address and support. Just to mention as well about in relation to providing support for people who are on remand, one of the issues at the moment is that they don't have access to offending behaviour courses, but they've not been convicted, and that it makes perfect sense. But they could access support for housing, for mental health, for substance misuse, whether they're found guilty or not. We're also conscious that in the report that Families Outside recently did on the financial impact of imprisonment, that people aren't accessing benefits when they come out from prison. It can take weeks, months, sometimes up to a year, actually get their benefits reinstated, and that doesn't set them up well at all in terms of being able to resist reoffending.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to bring in Russell, followed by Rona Mackay.
Okay, thank you, and good morning. I was struck, David, by your written submission. On page 25, you say that this is, I'm quoting, an opportunity to challenge the entrenched practices of some members of the judiciary who appear to accept the Crown's opposition to bail applications too readily. And on page 24, you say if this bill isn't acted, then it would be, we would suggest, significant cultural change, particularly among some parts of the Crown and judiciary, will be required for these changes to even take effect. So, you know, you're a former sheriff, so, you know, you come to this with that perspective. Can you perhaps even expand a bit on those cultural blockages or issues that exist and whether indeed the direction of travel is perhaps they're less prevalent than they used to be? I don't want to surmise or put words in your mouth, but...
Yeah. I do need to preface my answer by explaining that I am retired from being a full-time sheriff, but I do still sit on a part-time basis as a retired sheriff and have been helping out with a lot of the backlog that developed over COVID. I won't be sitting again until after April, but nonetheless, I am still a sitting sheriff. And secondly, I'm not here representing the judiciary in any way at all. My primary purpose here is as the chair of Howard League Scotland. But of course, I bring with me my personal experience as a sheriff working in this field, and so anything I say is entirely my own view. And the last thing I say is, don't think that I'm a typical sheriff. I'm not sure if there's such a thing, but I might not be representative of all sheriffs, but I hope of a growing number. Yes, I think these observations in the Howard League response really relate to the practice around the opposition to bail by the Crown and decisions on bail by sheriffs. And it is this perception that at the marking stage, decisions to oppose bail are made on an almost routine basis. Most often, in my personal experience, I don't have statistics to back this up, but in my personal experience, the most common ground for opposing bail is a likelihood of further offending, and in support of that, a schedule of previous convictions is presented. One would be forgiven for forming the impression that a decision to oppose bail is made simply because of the existence of a schedule of previous convictions. And I think it is an often fallacious assumption that the existence of previous convictions suggests a risk of further offending. And so if that forms the basis of opposition to bail, the position the sheriff is in is that they are very often having to make this important decision on liberty with very incomplete information. That might be the only official information they're given. They're then reliant upon submissions from the accused person's solicitor in opposition. We may come to it in another question, but I can't emphasise strongly enough the importance of the sheriff having information. Whether it takes the form of a formal risk assessment, to my mind, is of less importance than simply having information about the circumstances of the accused person. Because very often, when one looks behind the schedule of previous convictions, one finds that the person in this world, which is not divided conveniently into those who commit offences and their victims, but that person may themselves have a very traumatic background, may have been the victim of offending, but they may be already on a community payback order. They may just have got their first house in 5 years, and that's going to be their anchor for progression back into the community. These sorts of factors don't emerge unless somebody tells the sheriff. Very often, in the court I had the privilege of serving for 15 years in Alloa, I had the benefit of a supervised bail scheme and a social worker in court who could have a 10-minute interview with the accused person and provide a page and a half of information that was invaluable with that sort of background. Sometimes they were able to recognise the person. They might know them very well because there are frequent offenders who come before the court many times, and they might know that last week there was an updated criminal justice social work report prepared for that person, and that would be drawn down and made available to me in court. So it doesn't really take too much to open up access to significant, important information that would assist the sheriff in making decisions. But in a busy custody court, it does take a degree of resilience for a sheriff to keep saying no to the Crown. In the absence of additional information, in the absence of good advocacy, to say no to the Crown when an apparently unassailable case is being advanced that this person is liable to commit further offences. And so far as the cultural change is concerned, that is really a nod in the direction of the importance of everybody involved in the criminal justice system, but especially decision makers like sheriffs, to be trauma aware, to realise that the vast majority of people who appear in front of them are there as a consequence of their life circumstances, not so much because they're bad people, that the problem that's brought them there may not be addressed, may not be solved by custody. In fact, recognising that custody may make the matter worse, taking the trouble to learn from people like the witnesses you heard from yesterday, Professor McNeill, Hannah Graham, Leslie McCara, Cyrus Tata in Glasgow. There may be some colleagues of mine who don't know who these people are, but if we don't engage with criminologists and learn as we go, then we're not going to be sufficiently informed to make these important decisions. Decisions that might be right in law and unassailable on appeal, but wrong for the person.
Okay. Thank you. I don't know if either of you would like to come in on that, but I've got another question if you don't. So, no? Okay. So Victim Support Scotland told us that they believe it's inevitable that more people who get bail, more offences will be committed. Now, we know 1 in 8 crimes that are committed are by those who are on bail, and that 23% of bail orders were breached. So it seems logical that the more people are bailed, the more crime will be, the more work there will be for the police, and perhaps the busier the courts will become. Therefore, without fixing the bigger issue of support and investing in criminal justice social work and stop reoffending, this act, this bill, might fuel bail, fuel crime, and make things worse. Do you have any view on that? And whoever would care to respond.
I'd be happy to take that up. I completely disagree with that. I think it's the wrong approach. I think our starting point should be what is prison for, what is custody for, and the bill is pointing us in the right direction. It's for the protection of public safety. How we use prison, how many people are imprisoned, is actually more of a socio-political choice that we as a society make. The question sort of touches on the risk appetite of our community. I once met a Finnish judge, and Finland were imprisoning people at the time at the rate of something like 42 per 100,000, while we were at that time about 150. We've come down to 135 or thereabouts now. And I said to him, are we really that much more less law-abiding in Scotland than you are in Finland? Are we badder people in Scotland than you are in Finland? And he said, no, I don't think so. And I said, well, so how come you can keep the prison population so low? And he says, well, it's a decision we've made. It's quite hard. His answer was, it's quite hard on the rest of us, but that's what we've decided to do. Now, decades ago, we as a society made a decision in relation to mental health to do away with large residential institutions and move to care in the community. And that was a risk that society was prepared to take at that time, a risk that society was prepared to tolerate. And I think that the same issue arises in relation to offending. I repeat that the vast majority of people who are in this cohort fall into that category. They have experienced trauma. They themselves might have been victims of crime. They might have experienced adverse childhood experiences, and I'm sure I don't need to tell people on this particular committee that the significance of that, that having two or more of these experiences is likely to lead people into the criminal justice system. And so it is to recognise that the solution does not lie in prison, and that prison might make the matter worse. The way to reduce crime and reduce offending, to address the needs of the people who are committing the offences, is to address those needs. And a good example is in relation to drug treatment and testing orders. It's a very graphic example of how that works. The obvious proposition being that if someone is committing crime in order to acquire funds to feed their habit, then if you address the habit, you will address the crime. And that same principle can apply beyond just the realm of drug addiction. And that takes you into the whole realm of community justice, community-based disposals, and the extent to which services can be provided to support people away from an offending lifestyle. And I think that it's too simplistic to suggest that if there are more people who are not being remanded in custody, there's going to be more crime. I disagree, because the research, I can't quote it, and I can't direct you to it, but I listen to people like Professor McNeill and Hannah Graham and so forth, and we know from them that even a short period in custody, perhaps particularly a short period in custody, can be so disruptive and damaging that it increases the likelihood of offending on exit. So I think that the proposition that supports the suggestion you've made is fallacious for that reason.
Okay, thank you.
If I may
add to that just quickly. You mentioned at the end of your question about the need to increase support and so on from social work, and I would agree that actually answers a lot of that question. At the moment, there's a tendency to use bail as a period of kind of a waiting period, I suppose, prior to the trial, but also a period of supervision without the support that's required to address the issues that are causing the offence in the first place. And at the moment, throughout Scotland, the availability of that support is very patchy. So it's recognising whether that's due to cuts in local authority funding, whether it's due to cuts in third sector funding, or the issues that are, whatever issues there might be, is the fact that that support is not consistently available throughout the country. I think that goes back to the earlier question as well in relation to decisions for judges to use remand or bail, because they need to know what's available in their community. And if that support is not there, then the confidence in using those non-custodial options will be reduced as well. I'm also recognising that when someone decides to remand rather than bail someone, that impacts the family as well, and the family hasn't committed an offence, but they are punished, and that longer-term impact on the family is something that also needs to be taken into account.
Indeed, thank you.
Sure. I've just got a number of members coming in, and we'll just come back, sure. Russell, if that's okay. I'm going to bring in Rona and then Pauline.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Good morning. I've got three questions, one for each of you. Nancy, if I could start with you. You mentioned earlier your organisation's excellent report and very detailed report on the cost to families of imprisonment and release. If there was a key message from that, we don't have time to delve into it, obviously. If there's a key message, what would it be from you?
I think it's just making sure we recognise what that impact is and try to reduce that impact. The expense for families, particularly at remand and release, can cost up to half their income, just trying to maintain contact, whether it's, again, trying to make sure that people are at least, ideally where they're not put in prison in the first place, but if they are put in prison, that is placed some place that's accessible, that the families can travel to, and that the travel costs are supported. Again, recognising the families are not guilty. And again, making sure, I mentioned this earlier, that people have access to benefits from the point of release, rather than having to wait.
Do you think they're getting enough information about that?
It's having the information, it's having that practice recognised and firmly in place, because at the moment it is not prevented in the legislation for this to happen, but it just doesn't happen in practice. So it's something that's absolutely critical, because that burden is falling on families to support people on release.
Sure, thank you. Thank you. David, can I ask you your view on the removal of Section 23D and you know, whether women's organisations and victims are right to be concerned about this? And I presume you heard the earlier session where it was unanimously agreed that it should be removed. I still can't really get my head around that, but I mean, maybe you can give me your view.
Yes, I support the removal of it.
Okay.
The fundamental principles around which decisions on bail are made aren't changed. And the provisions in the bill provide sheriffs and judges with all of the discretion they need to address the concerns of victims. Victims' concerns are uppermost in decisions on bail, and the recognition of a risk of harm to complainers. I would quite like to have seen the expression intimate partners somewhere in this bill as a recognition of that particular concern. And the public are, in my view, adequately addressed. When one turns to the actual process of a decision being made, more important than the terms of the legislation is the information that's available to the person making the decision, and the accuracy of that information, and the concerns of a victim in a situation of domestic abuse or domestic violence would be more important than the precise terms of the legislation. There was an appeal decision not long after the Section 23D was introduced, which kind of made that point that the principles, even in relation to 23D, were no different from the principles applying to decisions on bail generally. But Section 23D placed an emphasis on serious offences and repeat serious offences. Mm-hmm. And so without diminishing the extent of the concerns of those, especially relating to domestic violence, I personally think that those concerns are misplaced and that, okay. that there can still be trust that good decisions can be made as long as the best information is made available and the best advocacy is available to those making the decisions.
Okay, thank you. I suppose, you know, from a non-legal point of view, in my mind is, well, why remove them anyway? What's the point? Because that doesn't send out a very good message to non-legal. If I was having a conversation with somebody, you said, well, why did they take those out? I mean, I'm not entirely sure I could convince them why, you know, from what I've heard this morning. The QC that was here referred to a case in Livingston and the introduction of 23D, which was in 2005. We now know it was a horrific case, you know, of someone being released. I don't know if you remember it. And then went on to kill a little 11-year-old boy and then he hanged himself. But that was a case where he had, you know, he'd got bail and it was so shocking, obviously, that the then First Minister decided that we needed to do something about it. So I'm unclear in my own mind about, you know, why they're being removed. It's
I can't comment on that case, especially whether the presence or otherwise of Section 23D had a bearing on the decision to release the person on bail.
Yeah.
And in cases like that, one would need to know what the allegation was on which the matter of bail was being decided. It probably wasn't any allegation of attempted murder or anything. It might have been a much lesser offence. I don't have an entrenched view on this. I think what I'm saying is that I have no concerns about Section 23 being removed.
That's good to know.
Why it's being removed, I don't think it makes a huge difference, to be honest.
Okay.
Because the corollary of the answer I've given is just that it doesn't really make a huge difference. Well, and that may be it, that there's a recognition now that Section 23D has become somewhat redundant.
Okay, well, that's reassuring in itself.
That's really what
thank
it
you.
Falls down to, yeah.
That's great. Wendy, if I could come on to you. The number of women in remand is shockingly high. I mean, really, I don't need to tell you that. And the disruption to families that follows from that is evident. Why do you think so many women are remanded for low-level offences, and why are they there in the first place? You heard the I don't know if you heard the previous session, but the solicitor had dealt with a case where the person was, you know, directed to the 218 project in Glasgow, which was hugely successful. And, you know, my question to her, well, if that happened more often, surely more women would not be remanded. And can I just have your view on that?
I wish I could give you the answer. I really wish I could give you the answer. And in fact, David is probably more qualified to answer than I am. But I thought a lot about this. You know, why out of the 7 people under the age of 18... why are they all on remand, you know, when we've got secure care sitting there, you know, with all the expertise and the staffing that could actually start to tackle the issues of why they're on remand.
Yeah.
And why so many women? And I've come up with the fact that it's just too complex for me and certainly out with my level of expertise. I can only give a personal answer looking at the research and the academia that I've looked at before. And I think is a combination of sheriffs not having a good collection of alternatives, which, you know, is really important, and a menu, if you like, supported bail being one of them. It's whether it's a backlog in COVID and actually greater offending has occurred in the middle, a lack of joined up thinking, a lack of informed decision making, whether there are sufficient diversions to not allow them to get to court in the first place, whether it's a risk averse approach. Mm-hmm. Whether I really don't know, but mm-hmm. I look at the figures and I think those two figures, 70% of women currently are on remand, and all 7 of people, or 6 or however many there are at the moment, are all on remand.
Yeah.
It needs a question, mm-hmm. and it needs to be answered.
Yeah. So, thank you. David, would you like to comment briefly on that?
Yes. I can't answer your question. I don't know why these decisions are being made. As of last night, the overall Roman population has crept up to 29.25%, if my arithmetic is correct, and in the female estate, 38.68% as of last night. Now, I know that you can't take one day's figures and build on it, but there seems to be a creeping trend. When our report was prepared, that you have in front of you from Howard League Scotland, these figures were 27 and I think 35. Mm-hmm. Anyway, the question in relation to women may not be unique to women. I think the decisions on bail are probably made in the same way, but there's an exaggerated Roman population in relation to women, and I am at a loss to understand how that can be. I shake my head in dismay that so many women are being remanded in custody, especially when we know that 70% of them will not receive a custodial sentence for the offence, even if they're found guilty, because these people are innocent until found guilty. But in a sense, this comes back to comments I made earlier about the appetite for risk. We have a presumption against custodial sentences under 12 months, which, as you probably know, is the custodial limit for summary offences. And it's in the summary court, the summary criminal court, the vast majority of the cases that are most disruptive to society occur. I think it's a mistake to call them the less serious cases, but the domestic abuse, public disorder, violence, lesser drug offences, these sorts of things, vandalism that can be disruptive to society, and the ones that perhaps impact most on individuals in society occur at that level. And I'm proud of the fact that we as a nation have made a statement that custody is no longer the default sentence for people who've committed offences at this level. But the corollary of that must be that the supports we want to put in place, the supports that people need to help them move away from an offending lifestyle and to address their needs to achieve that. The particular world of bail, though, and the immediacy of that decision that has to take place in the space of 24 hours, usually, of somebody being arrested and a decision being made, the unsung heroes in all of this are the criminal justice social workers. And if we're serious about providing sheriffs and decision makers with additional information, then these are the people who will do it. Now, in those areas where there exists a supervised bail scheme, there are measures available for sheriffs to receive reports from social workers, and I've explained what happened in my court in Alloa. It was invaluable. But I respectfully agree with the comments by Professor Macara yesterday that if we're taking this principle seriously to its logical conclusion, then we ought to elevate our thinking to the formation of a custody and bail unit of criminal justice social workers whose task is both to prepare reports, where possible risk assessments, but also to address the immediate issues of housing, mental health assessments in those cases where there might be a question of a hospital rather than a custody order being made, and really creating a resource that will address the needs of those who are arrested. That sounds like a council of perfection, but there's no harm in setting our sights high in achieving that.
Thank you.
Because in a perfect world, that's what we would have. All too often, people appearing. So
I wonder if I can maybe just intervene at that point. I think we're enjoying and finding significant value in your very comprehensive questions. I'm just mindful of time, and I've still got four members wanting to come in.
Okay.
I hate cutting you off.
No, not at all. No. I need that sometimes.
Yeah, I'm done. Of course.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I think it's what I said earlier about the patchy provision in terms of support for people on bail is actually exacerbated, particularly when we're talking about women in the justice system. It's not cost effective for local authorities to have one or two places on supervised bail set aside for women. So what it means is they don't fund them at all, and that means those options aren't available. Mm. So what we need to have is women don't fit the local authority approach. Mm. It needs to be more collaborative in terms of making sure they have the support they need, not people in other parts of Scotland can't really refer to 218, for example, and there's not that type of facility available readily in other parts of the country.
Yeah.
So I think we really need to think how we manage the situation of women separately. So what we end up with is people who need desperate amounts of support, and they end up being remanded in custody for their own safety, which is not how we're supposed to be using prison.
Yeah, thank you. That's really useful. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Rona. Okay, just on the point about under-18s that you were covering off earlier on, just worth noting that the committee's next bill will be the Children Care and Justice Bill, and this has a presumption in it to send under-18s to secure care and not prisons. So obviously we'll be looking more closely at this issue down the line. I'm going to bring in Pauline and then Jamie. Pauline.
Thank you very much. Good morning. I have two questions, one to David and one to Wendy. Can I begin, David, by just thanking the Howard League for the work they've done in highlighting not just the remand population, which first drew my attention to this horrendous issue for Scotland, but also the conditions in which prisoners have been held in remand in particular. And I think this committee are at one in terms of, we've also discussed it with the Chief Inspectorate, it's a situation we all want to get out of. So I just wanted to thank you for that. My question relates to, so in your submission, David, you see that you would like to see the bill also include provisions for discretion where it's unlikely to result in a custodial sentence. I just wondered if you could say more about that. I mean, I imagine not all cases you could know whether there's likely to be a custodial sentence or not, but anything you could tell the committee about how that would operate would be helpful.
Yes, well, this comes back to the point I've already made, that we have a presumption against custody under 12 months. There's a certain logic that if somebody is not going to receive a custodial sentence for the offence they've committed, and if assuming they're found guilty of it, then there's no justification for their being remanded in custody. It's as simple as that. The logic of that presumption were applied at this stage of decisions being made on bail, then one would imagine that a remand would become the exception rather than the norm. It's as simple as that.
My second question is to you, Wendy, and it might be another question you can't answer, but the committee were interested in this after their visit to the Glasgow Sheriff Court on Monday, and that is, so the profile of remand prisoners, so obviously looking at the distinction between summary cases and petition cases, so on Glasgow Sheriff Court on Monday was a summary court. Most of them were bail supervision cases that we saw, the 13 cases, so looked like the trend for the day. I believe those figures are available, and I wonder if you would agree, do you think it's quite important for us to analyse the remand profile, if you like, to try and understand, because it's still a bit mystifying as to why David mentioned earlier we're at 29.9%, because looking at summary justice, it's one day in the Glasgow Sheriff Court, the sheriff was very particular about applying that principle of only remanding where, you know, there was no other way that the sheriff could go in terms of bail supervision, etc. Mm-hmm. Could you comment on that or give us any information?
Oh, it's a difficult one. I actually think the gathering of data and statistics to inform why it's happening is really important. You know, why is bail being refused? Why are people on remand would actually really help. And although some statistics are gathered, by no means enough and by no means publicly available that we could actually draw some analysis and conclusions. That concept of informed decision is so important, and you'll see in the NPM submission that we say, you know, we would like the sheriff that must, the social services must provide a report. That's one of the things that we're really important about. But before that, the possibility of informed decision making absolutely relies on evidence in order to take that informed decision. And if we don't have the evidence of what brought people to tangle with the police in the first place, why they're on remand, why bail is being refused, it's very, very difficult to change a culture away from remanding.
Thank you. I was more thinking about looking at the profile of remand prisoners, let's say today. What would it look like in terms of categories of offences? So what would be the balance between petition and summary? I imagine it's more petition cases.
Yes.
So what would be the High Court cases and crimes of theft, dishonesty?
Mm-hmm. Do you
aware that information is available? Or
yes,
not?
Justice Analytical Services has a great deal of that information, yes. And
thank
I know
you.
That the last time I looked at it, what threw me was the number of cases or the high percentage of cases going to the High Court that were legacy sex offending. That really made me my eyes open. So I think you'll find that very interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm going to bring in Jamie and then Katie. Jamie.
Thank you. So one of the problems with legislating to change the parameters around the grounds on which bail can be permitted or refused is it's quite an all-encompassing approach. And I don't know if it necessarily accounts for the nuances that courts are. It applies to summary and solemn cases. It doesn't differentiate between domestic or non-domestic cases, nor does it take into account the nuances of specialist courts that deal with sexual abuse, drugs, youth or female courts, for example. So it takes a one-size-fits-all approach to those changes. My worry about that, and I wondered if you might comment, is that the right approach? Should there be a more nuanced approach in legislating when we make changes to refusing grounds for bail as the bill currently proposes to do? I'll maybe start off. So quite an open question, then I'll maybe zoom in on some specific scenarios. Professor Lokes.
I'm not sure that's something that I would be qualified to answer, I'm
okay,
afraid, but be happy to comment in general.
No problem.
I think there is an issue that we need to look at in terms of the levels of legal aid that are provided, because I'm aware that, just referring to Holly McNeill's question about what happens after people are remanded into custody, but the fact that there's a backlog because there aren't the solicitors available to take up their cases, they're not solicitors, judges, lawyers, taking on legal aid work because it's not worth their while.
Mm-hmm.
So you have people who are lacking representation and not able to proceed with their cases on that basis as well. But I'll leave it there. I know they're much greater experts to my left.
I can't absolutely comment on the what you're talking about. I think there's a real need for the bill to be operationalised. It hasn't been defined as yet. But with Nancy, anecdotally, what we're finding when we're going into prisons is people, A, say it, telling us, whether or not it's true, I don't know, and we haven't done the research and evidence to back it up, was that they are pleading guilty because it'll be a shorter time in order to be in prison. And secondly, that they cannot get legal representation. So it's interesting that two organisations are getting the same anecdotal feedback.
I mean, those are problems that the bill doesn't address or fix, one being the backlog or the amount of time people have been held on remand waiting trial, which we know is an issue, or the suspicion that the defence lawyers may be saying just plead guilty, the sentence will be lesser than the amount of time you may spend on remand, so you're still in the same environment but you just have fewer rights and options open to you, and that is worrying actually. Mr. Mackey, I wonder if you could go back to the original question around the, you'll know you sit in the court, that they do deal with different cohorts of people in different ways, but the bill doesn't do that.
I think the answer to the question is helped by understanding how the question of bail is actually dealt with in legislation. There's no attempt in legislation to establish a detailed list of regulations that address or attempt to address every possible scenario. The approach starts with the European Convention on Human Rights, which says that everybody is entitled to bail. That's the starting point. Every person accused of an offence is entitled to bail, full stop. And what our legislation does is to then address the exception that there are if there are reasons justifying the withholding of freedom, then these are they. And what the bill is doing is resetting the bar, effectively, restating the principles that decision makers, judges and sheriffs take into account when they're deciding bail. The way nuances in individual cases are addressed is through the information that's available to the decision maker. Rather than being concerned about creating legislation that endeavours to address every circumstance, the judges and sheriffs are provided with a wide discretion in addressing these issues. How that discretion is used is the important point, and that relies so heavily upon, first of all, how well informed the decision maker is in general terms with what might be called judicial knowledge. And I think in these days judicial knowledge includes trauma awareness and that sort of thing. But most importantly, having access to risk assessments in the most serious cases and solemn cases that might involve allegations of murder, rape and so forth, risk assessments. But without becoming too preoccupied about the availability of risk assessments, which make a particular demand on resources and time in what is a very time-critical situation, just information about the background of the accused person, the victim or victims, their families. There's one thing that I am going to just mention here, I hope not out of turn, that I share the disappointment of families outside that there's no specific reference to children and the requirement for courts to have regard to the interests of children affected by decisions on bail in this bill.
I appreciate we're tight on time, but from what I saw at the Sheriff Court in Glasgow on Monday is that these are factors that sheriffs do consider. You know, if it's a young person, a female accused, someone with that's been declared as having mental health or addiction complications, someone who has a full-time job, for example, that was clearly a factor in some of the cases, and the mention of children or being the carer for somebody in there. So these are already factors. Why do we need to bake that into the legislation?
Well, I think I absolutely agree. The sheriffs do take account of that. They suck in whatever information they can take, and they have regard to these circumstances. But I think in terms of the basis on the statutory basis on which decisions are made and the perception of society and the world on how we approach these questions, I think that the recognition of the rights of children should be given prominence, because to be perfectly honest, some sheriffs are more aware of that than others. Sheriffs and judges are having to begin to grapple with the true impact or the true implications of the convention. Because if a person with childcare responsibilities who's a primary carer of a child is sentenced to prison, the interests of that child go from being a primary consideration under the convention to the paramount consideration. And judges may have to start thinking in terms not only of recognising that there's a child affected by the decision, but actually ensuring that the interests of that child are then taken care of. So it's for that reason that I think that there's merit in considering a specific reference to the rights of children in the bill.
I apologise, it's not my nature to interject, but I just want to get through my questions. And well, I was going to pose a scenario to you, and it fits in nicely with the mention of children. If over the course of a weekend, let's say an adult male beats up his wife or partner or a child and appears in custody on a Monday morning, and that's a reasonable scenario that happens, unfortunately, would it be your view that the default position would be that that person would be released on bail, or in that, or in those scenarios where there's clearly an act of domestic violence, an assault has taken place on any member of the household, yeah, that person rightly should be held on demand. What would your default position as a sitting sheriff be?
Well, there is no default position. The starting point is that person is no different from any other accused person, that they are entitled to bail unless there are reasons not to grant bail. And then one would consider the particular circumstances of the case. And it's impossible to give any kind of general answer, because so much depends on the circumstances. So, for example, if there were special conditions that would realistically have a prospect of keeping them apart and keeping the alleged complainer victim safe, then that might be considered. And it's very common in cases like that for conditions to be put in place prohibiting the accused person from having contact with the alleged victim, approaching her. There might be conditions excluding them from an area or even a whole town. there was a famous case years ago where somebody was excluded from the whole country. But there are a range of possibilities there. But if the information made available to the court made it clear that even the existence of bail conditions, if there's a strong history of repeated offences of violence involving this couple, then it may well be that the only solution is to remand that person in custody. And so from my answer, you'll see that so much depends on the particular circumstances of each individual case, but it cannot be... I think it would be dangerous to have what you describe as a default position, that when an allegation of that arises, the person accused should be remanded in custody. You mustn't forget that a common occurrence in cases like that is that when all the turmoil settles down, the alleged victim starts making requests for her partner to be released because she relies on him for support, for childcare, for income, and they have a family. And so these very, very complex challenges can arise a week or two later.
And my final question is one specific issue, and that's if the changes that are in the bill do come to fruition and the public safety consideration is the primary consideration for whether bail is granted or otherwise, what powers does the sheriff have to deal with the issue of repeat non-appearances? Because that has been specifically raised with us, and there is a concern that people who simply fail to appear at future diets, sometimes custody is the only way to ensure their presence at the trial, for example. If the sheriff has nothing up their sleeve to make sure that that person appears, having considerably breached on a number of occasions historic appearances, they don't have that ability. And how do we deal with that?
Well, the sheriff still has that power, but it's been modified in the bill. In summary cases, I think the proposed section appears to endeavour to address that very point, that somebody can be remanded in custody for a failure to appear at court, but only if they have previous convictions for failing to appear at court, either for in respect of bail or for actual court hearings. And the point that we made in the Howard League Scotland response was to put some kind of time limit on how old those previous convictions might be, because somebody might appear in court with a conviction might be several years old that would fit that criteria and would justify a remand in custody. So my basic answer to your question is that the sheriffs still have that power, and there's the wider provision about interfering with the course of justice. But in relation to summary cases, there is that power, and in solemn cases, it's not watered down at all. So I think... That is how that's been addressed, and it seems to be an endeavour to avoid unnecessary remands in custody of people who are otherwise not a risk to society. And it perhaps says more about keeping in touch with people, how we keep in touch with them, how we keep tabs on them, how we get them to court, persuade them to come to court, for a cohort who are very vulnerable and chaotic.
Thanks, Mary. I appreciate the time.
Not at all. I'm going to bring in finally Katie and then Fulton, and then we will have to bring the panel to a close.
Thank you. In the last session, we heard some evidence in relation to the central marking of cases and the decisions that the Crown makes as to whether to oppose bail or not. And in particular, there was a suggestion that there needed to be more discretion from Procurator Fiscals, that they should be given more ability to use their discretion in the courts, rather than having to go up a managerial chain and impose, if you like, central policy. We'll be meeting with and hearing evidence from the Crown next week, and I would be interested in any thoughts in terms of changes you think there needs to be in relation to practices or indeed process or policy in terms of Crown decisions, and whether you've got any thoughts on that. Maybe that you don't have an opinion and it's something that you feel you don't have expertise in.
I don't know enough about what the Crown practices and procedures are to say what they should or should not be doing. What I can say is, though, that there's value in having a regular deputy in court who sort of takes ownership of the case and understands the approach of the court to questions of bail. And that was something I've benefited from in practice in my small court in Alloa, that we usually had deputes who were there for years at a time and a certain common understanding emerged as to the sort of information the sheriff would want and the particular considerations that the sheriff would take into account in deciding bail. It's a difficult question because the Crown is dealing with a large volume of cases and they have to be marked, and some view on bail has to be taken. And so questions of defensive decision-making and such like arise, but I'm not in a position to comment beyond that.
And similar, the other question that I had again, and it may be that you feel that this isn't something that you would be able to add to, but in we've heard about the importance of information being provided to the sheriff and to the court. And in the last session, again, we were told that if you go back to the 1990s, the early 2000s, there was better provision of social workers in the courts. Now, that's quite anecdotal in that there may be great geographical differences in terms of the level of provision. And I just wondered whether you have are able to point us to any evidence or work that's been done in terms of the availability of that support in the court, because it's really a resource issue rather than necessarily a legal issue. But I just wondered if you've got any experience in relation to that.
Sorry. No, not particularly, but I think that I agree that resourcing is a huge issue in relation to social work in particular. I know that the court-based social workers aren't available in many courts. There are other ways of gathering that information, depending on what time of day the information is requested, whether you can request a stand-down report, for example. There are also creative ways of working around that. For example, the Prison Reform Trust has just introduced child impact assessments, which are actually assessments that can inform, social workers can inform the courts, but are actually done by a person that the child chooses. So whether that's a teacher, whether that's a health professional, whether that's a school dinner lady in one case, that information is still available, and social work has very much welcomed that approach in terms of being able to provide that information without necessarily requiring additional resource from social workers who are very, very overstretched.
Yeah, and my final question is in relation to the public safety test, whether you support you know, that inclusion in the bill. I think you've spoken about that a little bit already, whether you think that is a helpful addition to the bill, whether you think it will make no difference whatsoever, but may create uncertainty, and we've heard it might lead to appeals to as we try and clarify what it means. But if there is going to be provision, and I know that yourself, David Mackey, have already made some suggestions in terms of additional provisions that could be put in the legislation that may be of assistance. But if there is going to be a test of that nature, how we could define it, if you've any suggestions in relation to that.
I hesitate to try and offer a definition. I think that, first of all, public safety was already is already in the existing legislation as part of the definition of public interest, and the bill seeks to restrict it to public safety. And I think that I would echo comments that are made by in the response by the judiciary and others. That it would be helpful to have a definition of what public safety means. And I, in one sense, I'm not ducking the question. I think I would need to reflect on what I think the definition should be, but in a sense, and I'm, it would be probably inappropriate for me as a sheriff to attempt to do that, but in a sense, that's the very sort of question that policymakers on behalf of the community would do for us. What is meant by public safety? Because at the moment, if that's the expression that's left, what I think may happen is that different sheriffs and judges will apply their own interpretation to that, and it's a very wide scope for interpretation, and we may then have a process of a clarity being emerging only through appeal decisions. So I think there is there would be benefit in an attempt being made to offer some definition for the benefit of judges and for consistency in bail decisions.
Thank you.
And finally, Fulton.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I'll try to be brief. I had three questions. I say had because my colleague Katie Clark actually picked up on the question I was going to ask to yourself, David, and that was about the Crown's processes. We heard that from both yourself and the previous panel. So I think just for today, it's probably suffice to say that both of you have given us some information that we can take into next week's session. So that's been very helpful. Nancy, in relation, the question I had for yourself is about the input of criminal justice social work, which the bill obviously proposes. And you've talked a wee bit about it. We did hear from previous panels, not today's previous panel, but I think it was either last week or that perhaps how this process could involve the third sector, more organisations like yourself, but also others that are working in the community. Do you have any idea how that might happen, and would you welcome approaches from criminal justice social workers to talk to you about, and seek advice and guidance on how families might be impacted by decisions?
Absolutely, and that's something that we already do to some extent, where social workers are aware of us and have that communication. The role of criminal justice social work is very much focused on the person who is accused or convicted of the offence, whereas our focus is on support for the family and what that means for them. So I think there really are kind of parallel priorities in that sense. The social workers, particularly for a longer sentence, are required to visit the family, but in the family's experience, that's often in relation to what the person in prison needs as opposed to what the families themselves need. So I think we do need to look more at what this means for families, where families might need protection, where families might need additional support, particularly families that are struggling financially. Again, the financial impact report that I mentioned, we have families who are simply not eating at the moment because they can't afford to, because they're pouring in money to either to the person in prison or trying to maintain that contact. So there are a number of ways. We often have conversations with children and family social workers as well in relation to the appropriateness of contact and the child's right to contact under Article 9 of the UN Convention, but whether that's safe and appropriate and how we can support that. So yes, there's a lot we can do, as well as for supervision on release, support and supervision on release, where criminal justice social work might be seeing someone 45 minutes every fortnight. There is a role for the family to provide that more day-to-day support, not just as a tool, but in recognition for the support that they might need to support someone coming out of prison.
But if the suggestions that have been put forward by this bill are realised, it will increase the opportunity for that joint up at that stage, which is the stage before a decision is made in bail.
It is very useful that the bill provides those opportunities, but it doesn't state explicitly how that might work. And I think there is certainly a role for, again, third sector organisations and for families to be recognised in what that needs to include and have them involved as a kind of part and parcel of the process rather than as an exception and at the discretion of the social work team. So it's trying to make sure that it's actually a given rather than an exception.
Thanks very much. And Wendy, for yourself, if I may, it's more of a general or a philosophical, whichever word you want to use, question, if you like. We've heard quite a lot of evidence, including the previous panel and in last week where we had the academics. Something that I think is generally shared by committee, and I think you've also hinted at it yourself before, that if we're going to invest more in community, and this is one example of that at the bail stage, that ultimately there might be a saving in prisons. Now, nobody's expecting that to be overnight. There would need to be a long period where both are funded, at a similar level, community justice perhaps more, and that's something I'm going to ask the Cabinet Secretary about. But in time, we should see that change, and that would be the hope and the desire. How do you think the prison services, and yourself in your own role, would feel about that? Is that something that you're supportive of, or would you be resistant to that change, if that makes sense?
I have repeatedly talked about my concerns with overcrowding in our current prison estate. I don't think I've been anything other than robust in that one. So I think every single person who works in the prison service and the whole of my organisation would applaud a reduction in the numbers. And I don't think, unfortunately, it's a binary qualification yet, and I take your point. You know, the reality is if we can get the prison numbers down, the existing prison staff can do so much more in terms of reassessing what they need to do, providing purposeful activity, actually reducing the risk of that person leaving the prison and therefore benefiting the community. In the longer term, if you could reduce the prison numbers to the extent that other European nations have, like Holland, Portugal, then I think that as a taxpayer, I would be absolutely delighted. But if for that funding to be able to go into the community to either divert from prosecution, to prevent the problems happening in the first place, or finding alternatives to prison that are more effective, I think there's not one single person in the justice system who wouldn't be delighted. So.
Very eloquently put, as ever. Thank you, Wendy. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, I am going to have to bring this panel to a close. I'm sure we could continue for much longer, but may I extend my thanks to the panel this morning. It's been a really invaluable session, so thank you again. And we'll just have a short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave and have a very quick comfort break. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. So our final panel today consists of one witness. Unfortunately, Chief Superintendent Gordon McCreedy has submitted his apologies. So we've got with us Chief Inspector Nick Clasper of Policy and Partnerships within the Criminal Justice Services Division of Police Scotland. So you're on your own, Chief Inspector, this morning, but a warm welcome to you. So we have around about 45 minutes for the session. We may have to cut it a little bit due to the previous panels overrunning, but we'll see how we go. So I will just start off asking you a very general question, and it's just in relation to the information that the police include in police reports that inform the fiscal and the court on information around decision making on bail, and clearly Police Scotland officers have a role in informing that process. So it might be helpful if you were able just to set out the type of information that is included in police reports around, in particular, bail, and whether you officers recommend that bail be sought or otherwise. So over to you.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, committee, and thank you very much. The standard prosecution report is the means by which police officers will present the information to the Crown with regards to the individual. There are two sections in particular which police officers will complete in the prosecution report in respect of the individual and their circumstances. The first are the antecedents, which relate to the background of the individual, family circumstances, employment, earnings, benefits, etc. The second part of the report is specifically about bail, and it asks a number of bail questions around about offending, previous convictions, whether they've previously offended on bail, and it does also ask for the officer to provide a view on whether or not they support a release on bail or not, and if they do, whether they believe any special conditions would be appropriate for the case that's being submitted.
Very much. And just following on from that, one of the issues that we've been looking closely at is the voice of victims, complainers and witnesses. To what extent do you include information from, and I'll just sort of confine this to victims, in your police report?
We do, certainly. When it comes to specific examples like domestic abuse, we specifically give the Crown information on the victim's view as to bail, any conditions that maybe they feel may be appropriate. So that's covered also as part of the standard prosecution report.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm sure there'll be probably some more questions around that particular issue. So I'm going to hand over to Russell Finlay. Russell.
Yeah, hello, good morning. Good afternoon, even. Now, the Scottish Police Federation have submitted some written evidence, and they take the view that they aren't entirely sure what problem needs to be fixed. They're already of the view that their members see people being bailed almost as a matter of routine in respect of police bail, and those that are kept in custody, pretty much the majority of them are granted bail by court. Do you think there's a slight disconnect between the reality of what's happening on the ground and what we're hearing about from some other witnesses, that too many people are indeed being remanded?
Obviously, the question around about remand is obviously one for the sheriff and the judicial decision maker. Officers will obviously present all the available information with respect to the background of the individual to try and fully inform and allow the sheriff to make an appropriate decision when it comes to bail. We've recently been working closely with Community Justice colleagues and Social Work Scotland to enhance an information sharing agreement to ensure justice social work have access to court custody lists in the morning in order that they can advance triage those who they believe may be bail opposed, and that will allow them to get an earlier start on preparing information to allow the sheriff to have that to hand when the decision's made.
Okay, thank you. Another issue that the SPF have raised, and they're not, as far as I'm aware, giving evidence in person, but it's in response to the release of people from prison. They say that Police Scotland is already struggling, and I'll quote, with the management of high-risk offenders and cannot safely manage this within current resourcing arrangements. Do you agree with that interpretation, that right now Police Scotland cannot manage high-risk offenders in the community? And whatever your answer to that, what happens next if indeed this bill comes to pass?
Police Scotland have robust processes in place to manage offenders when they come into the community, be it on release from prison or release from court on bail. We have a number of approaches where we can examine the potential risk that individual poses and put in specific safeguards around about enhanced checks. I would draw the committee's attention to our approach to domestic violence, where we specifically go and visit offenders released on bail to remind them of their responsibilities. Undoubtedly, if there were to be an increase in the number of persons on bail, that would undoubtedly create a further demand on resources for Police Scotland, and we would need to consider how best to manage that risk going forward.
I think it's twofold, isn't it? It's the managing of people who may be bailed, but also the early release of prisoners that might need some form of monitoring as part of their condition of release. In respect of that element, that cohort, is it the case that Police Scotland cannot safely manage this within current resourcing arrangements, as the Federation states?
No, I don't believe that would be the case. At the moment, Police Scotland manage those individuals who come into the community effectively and efficiently. We obviously look to identify methods of mitigating that risk and how best to support those individuals reintegrating into the community. Ultimately, obviously, the aim is to ensure that their successful reintegration prevents further offending and they re-enter the community from that point.
Okay, thank you, Chief Inspector. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Anyone else like to come in at the moment? Jamie.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chief Inspector. So I just wanted to pick up, following on from the last line of conversation around the duties on the police or enhanced responsibilities which result from an increased volume of people on bail. We also know, as was mentioned in the last session, and I don't know how up to date the figures are, perhaps something the parliamentary research team could help us with, but we did, the last time I checked, 1 in 8 crimes were committed by someone on bail. I don't know in terms of volume how many crimes that is, but it's a fair amount. Now, obviously, the police are the front line to deal with reported crime. They are the responsible for not just the handling of the reporting of it, and we can talk about one-on-one calls till the cows come home, but that's another matter for another day. But you essentially have to turn up or deal with the initial report and perhaps even the potential arrest and custody of somebody over the weekend, for example. Is there an inevitability that if the bail population, if you like, to turn the phrase on its head, from remand population increases, that the number of offences committed by people on bail will also increase? Or would that be a wrong assertion?
I don't think I'm qualified to make that assumption. However, the empirical data does show that there is about a 17 to 19% offending rate for individuals who are on bail. And if you follow that empirical data, it may be the case. However, that doesn't necessarily correlate with what effect further measures around about mitigation may have on bail compliance. So it would be difficult to say one way or the other whether that would be an actual outcome.
Yeah, let's imagine it did, though. And I think for all intents and purposes, you have to scenario plan, because presumably that has a knock-on effect on you and your resource and your ability to deal with that. If there is an increase, would that require additional resource or funding? Would you be under your current... And I know police have a heavy workload as it is, dealing with a whole wide range of emergency situations that other agencies perhaps ought to be dealing with. We've taken evidence, that's a matter of public record already, to that effect. Would this put any increased pressure on the police if they were dealing with that 17 to 19% of reoffending whilst on bail, if the numbers increase? And what would you say to frontline officers who perhaps are concerned, and maybe they've elicited those concerns through the Federation rather than directly to the committee, but if they do have concerns about potential increases in workload due to changes in bail conditions or the rules around which bail is granted, what would you say to alleviate your officers' concerns?
So, obviously, if there was an increase in demand, that would increase workloads, and without any increase in resourcing, that would have to be met through our existing staffing. The position would be, obviously, that if there was to be an increase in demand on frontline policing, we would obviously look for an increase in resourcing to match that. One of the issues that was pulled out in the financial memoranda was the fact that it was an unknown at the moment, and therefore we were unable to quantify what that would potentially look like without some form of indication as to how many extra individuals may be on bail and any correlated increase in offending or bail offences that go with it. The Chief Constable has obviously stated publicly that he's currently reviewing the Police Scotland structure and focusing on public protection, etc., as a priority. So I would say that one of those public protection around about domestic offending, sexual offending, and bail associated with that would obviously be something that would be looked at.
Yeah, I mean, that's entirely the answer I think I expected you to say, and I think it's entirely appropriate that if your workload is increased, that then the government must rise to the occasion in that respect. But just on another issue around the monitoring of people. So, for example, if there's a political decision to have fewer people held on remand and more people subsequently may be given bail, that is the premise of the legislation after all. But on the other hand, there is an increase or additional conditions or monitoring that goes around that, either electronic monitoring or other forms of restriction of liberty. What role do you think the police would play in any or all of this, or none at all, if it's purely just down to criminal justice social workers or other agencies to meet that role? Or do you think the police would have quite an active role in ensuring that those who are out on bail, who may, by up to 20%, be that cohort of people who may reoffend whilst on bail, what duty do you have to ensure that public protection is paramount?
Obviously, our duty around about risk to the public and assessing that risk for an individual who is on bail is part of our existing processes. Where it's assessed that individual poses a higher risk, we can put additional measures in place. I've already referred to the further visits of the domestic offenders to ensure they're aware and remain compliant when it comes to their bail conditions. Can I just clarify, you mentioned electronic monitoring there. Were you looking for the police involvement around about electronic monitoring?
Only if you think you would be involved.
So, yes, we are. My team has been very closely involved with partners on the implementation of electronic monitoring to the organisation. We generally, Police Scotland will deal with any report of a breach of electronic monitoring in the same way as we would deal with a report from a member of the public that bail had been breached or so on. So, therefore, the demand in relation to electronic monitoring is something that we've previously raised, or the Chief Superintendent actually raised at the SPA. one of the good things about electronic monitoring is it obviously provides that constant, consistent assurance that bail's being adhered to, whereas previously, for example, for a curfew, it'd be dependent on officers attending at the address, knocking on the door. However, what that also means is that we are now aware of every single time that a person is not within an address, and we now also deal with that as a breach of bail and investigate it and report it accordingly.
Yeah, that's really interesting, because I guess if things were more people-based or manual, there's a sort of mystery shopping element. You turn up at the address, and if they're not where they should be, you take appropriate action. But now you do know, in real time, I suppose, of every breach that's occurring and have a duty to respond to that. Are you able to? I mean, is it physically possible for you to turn up to every address and every person who's tagged and deal with that situation if they're somewhere they shouldn't be? Or is it something you just have to compile reports and let it accumulate?
At the moment, our system's set up so that the breach of bail is reported directly into the control centres, and they carry out a risk assessment around about the breach. However, they are tasked out to response officers to go and deal with, in a similar way that if somebody phoned in to the police to say that they'd seen their neighbour who they knew was on curfew leave, we would also deal with that in exactly the same way. So it's about the route of reporting as opposed to the fact it's electronic monitoring.
Interesting. I'm keen to let others come in if they want. I only have one question at the end if we've got time around serious organised crime. Thanks.
Katie.
I was wanting to go back, if you like, to the beginning of the process in terms of bail, because we've heard of the importance of sufficient information being provided to the court in relation to bail decisions. And we've also heard that often the social work provision that ideally we'd want there to be in place just isn't there. And I just wonder how that interfaces with your work. I mean, obviously the police are not social workers, but presumably you have to go some way down that path to be able to ensure that there is sufficient information. And if you could maybe comment on that in terms of not just the resource implications, but to what extent you are able to go down that path to ensure that there's a holistic understanding of the situation when the court's making a decision.
At the moment where somebody appears in court and the Crown need further information, they can and often do try to make contact with the reporting officer to try and get further information around about that individual. That may or may not be possible depending on shift patterns. However, it falls back to the initial point from the convener around about the sufficiency of information within the standard prosecution report to ensure that that broad and balanced decision is made by the sheriff. We do work with the Crown in respect of regularly reviewing the information that they require within the report. So again, that is an area where if it is felt that there's not sufficient information being provided to the Crown, they would advise us and we would then look at whether or how we would provide further information for them.
To maybe use an example, it was pointed out to us that the interests of children obviously need to be a top priority. To what extent would you get involved in getting sufficient information about that, or would you feel that you'd have to refer to other agencies?
When it comes, for example, if we're looking at domestic abuse, there is a requirement within the format of the domestic abuse report to look at children within the household. And, for example, as an aggravator if there is a child present during a domestic abuse crime. So that's something that we would actually look to and would include in the standard prosecution report. As regards any views of children, that's not something we would look at the moment. However, I'm aware, and having listened to the earlier panel, that the convention may change that as we move forward. However, that will obviously be something that will be done in conjunction with the Crown.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Can I maybe just come back in, Chief Inspector, and just move the line of questions on to the plans around release from custody? So you'll be aware that Sections 9 and 10 of the Bill relate to release planning and through care support for prisoners. And I know already Police Scotland have close relationships with the Scottish Prison Service around a range of issues, but particularly that point of release for an individual. So with the aim of supporting sort of successful integration for individuals back into the community, as I say, Section 9 and 10 include those provisions. And those sections also make reference to Police Scotland. So what in practice would you expect the sort of police input around that to involve going forward that perhaps isn't already in place already? And picking up on, I think, the point specifically that Jamie's referenced is the impact on police resources. Should that become, or should practice around that change?
Well, Police Scotland, as you've alluded to, do have good working relationships with our community justice partners, and around about release planning, we will be involved in the discussions, particularly in respect of community risk and any risk or that may pose on release for the community or the individual themselves being released into that community. We're certainly content that that's something that we do at the moment. And if there is an increase in demand in that respect, then again, as a reference to Mr. Green, that any increase in demand may necessitate a consideration of increased resource. Where you're transferring risk from one part of the criminal justice system into the other, there may be a necessity for a rebalancing of funds to follow that risk. And it would certainly be worthy of consideration. And again, I refer back to the financial memo. This is very much an unknown quantity. So we were unable to actually give a precise indication of what this impact may be.
Thank you. That's interesting. And remaining on this sort of release point, if you like, we've heard earlier on evidence around the importance or the value of, for example, third sector and other organisations starting their through care support before an individual is released. Do you have any observations on whether there is a role prior to release, a pre-release role, if you like, for Police Scotland, again, that perhaps isn't in place already and that would fit within the provisions of the bill?
I think Police Scotland would obviously become involved in the latter stages. Ultimately, prior to any planning, the vast majority of this would sit with other bodies other than ourselves. We obviously would be and are happy to join in and be involved in those discussions around about the plans for moving forward. However, I don't have any further comment on that, I'm afraid.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I think, Jamie, you were wanting to come back in, and then we'll probably bring the session to a close.
Yeah, thanks. Just a few other things that popped into my mind. How do you think we're going to be able to quantify that rebalancing, I think is the word you used? As you say, if we're shifting the balance of risk from one element of the criminal justice system to another, in this case, to the police, and the financial memorandum is suitably vague in its analysis of that, other than just the volume of people that may shift from remand to release on bail. What piece of work needs to be done ahead of the bill progressing through this committee or through the Parliament to give you satisfaction that policy shift and rebalance will be matched by financial rebalancing?
Thank you. One of the challenges we highlighted in the original consultation was around about the uncertainty as to what is a public safety test and how that would then impact on the existing provisions and the existing situation. I've watched the earlier sessions and obviously significant discussions around about Section 23D. Mm-hmm. And our position around about that was that we were concerned that without some form of definition as to what public safety actually is, that any diminution of rights or protections for victims and or witnesses, and also elements of removing the judicial discretion around about that. In regards to what work needs to be done, perhaps there is scope for trying to understand what exactly the changes that are proposed will mean in respect of the increase in numbers who will be admitted to bail. Unfortunately, I don't think that's an easy piece of work. And listening to the previous panel and the sheriff who's there, I think he's quite artfully articulated the challenges that the judiciary have in trying to work out who should and shouldn't be admitted to bail.
Another parallel question is one around those changes itself, and that's clearly at the moment one of the considerations that sheriffs give is serious consideration of a risk of interference with witnesses or victims if someone is granted bail. Now, if there are any changes to that, now there's a mixed opinion on that. There are people who think that that ground for refusal has been diminished, and others who believe that it still will exist and is protected in the new legislation. I'm not quite sure I know the answer to that. But if there is any risk that that is either taken away or diminished in any way, what concerns might you have or the police might have that those accused of probably quite serious crimes but do not necessarily pose any immediate public safety risk, but nonetheless do possess quite a significant risk of interference or prejudice to justice?
That was the concern we picked up during the consultation, that without any degree of clarity as to what a public safety test would mean around about the protection of witnesses and victims. And in fact, we also raised a concern around about, for example, witnesses to organised crime who weren't covered in the initial consultation. Without a better understanding of how that would impact, we would remain concerned over the changes moving forward.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. And finally, Fulton, I think you want to come in with am I correct? No?
Yes, thanks, convener. Just a couple of quick questions for the panel. Thanks very much for your evidence. I think it's been the shortest panel so far anyway. So thanks very much for that. I just wanted to ask about one of the concerns that we heard was that it's in terms of non-appearance at court and the seriousness of that, but at the same time, trying to balance that against whether these individuals should really be remanded just because they're not attending at court, and that every other factor doesn't suggest that they need to be remanded. So we've heard this in a couple of panels, including, I think, both of today's panels, or at least one of them, and we've heard it previously. And I wondered if that is an area that maybe the police would have some sort of role in. I don't know, it wouldn't be anything to do with the bill, I don't think, but maybe a policy off the police to explain the seriousness of attending court. I know you do that anyway, but perhaps look at it in another way, because if this bill is going to have the effect of not of people who are not going to receive remand based on just not appearing at court, I suppose it's a very broad question actually. I'm just wondering what role you think the police might be able to have in that to ensure people are attending at court and not putting themselves in a position where they've not appeared five times or whatever the case may be, and we all know it can even be more than that.
Thank you. So the issue of non-appearance at court also places a demand on the police insofar as where an individual doesn't appear in general terms, there is a warrant issued for their arrest, which requires police inquiry, apprehension, and then presentation before the court. With regard to the actual notification to individuals about court dates, court appearances, the police are not always privy to all of those dates, so it may not be an appropriate role for us. However, we would obviously, during the consultation, we did raise the initial concern that there was no mention of the administration of justice. And having worked closely with colleagues in Social Work Scotland and Community Justice Scotland for the last 18 months, I'm aware that the use of bail supervision or some form of support during bail to actually assist individuals remember when to go to court, for those examples, those who may have addiction issues, mental health issues, or live chaotic lifestyles, that may be an opportunity to actually prevent them not appearing in the first place, and then pulling them back into arrest, custody, and a presentation at court again.
Okay, thank you very much. If there are no more questions, that's been a nice, neat panel just to end our morning. Thank you very much, Chief Inspector. We appreciate your time. That concludes the public part of our agenda, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you very much.